Welcome to the latest edition of the SWM podcast, our first returning guest, the first episode of season two. This will be the first episode in 2021 as well, even though it's been recorded in start November pull back the curtain. But if you're on Patreon, you should have already listened to them all anyway, so it's all good.
You mean tell me that this isn't live? It's not live.
No, I haven't figured out how to be honest.
It's live to tape.
Exactly.
It was live at some point.
I'm not editing it, so it's as good as life.
too much work.
If you don't know, my name is Billy Strachan. I am the host of this podcast. Of course, I've appeared on the WWE Network, so you can call me WWE Network's own Billy Strachan. I am joined by Scotty Swift, whose nicknames include Grand City, Grand City Warrior. Grand City Ghostbuster is what I called you last time.
I didn't come up with any of my nicknames. People just gave them to me, so...
I'm sure
one of them came from Brian Tucker. The red-haired warrior was his, he said at one time. And Don Cena, that popped some of the boys. Some people took that as like an insult. It's like, no, John Cena's great, so it's fine. How's that an insult? I don't know.
The champ is here and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, Don Cena. Right, so I've still got like half a page of notes, but we're going to start with the story that you teased at the end of the last episode. Which was you said you had a story about Five Star Wrestling. I want to know this. For anyone unaware of Five Star Wrestling, how do you not know about Five Star Wrestling? Its last scene was Bram giving everyone two middle fingers, which, you know, if anything, summed up a company. Five Star Wrestling. What was your involvement or how were you... What's your story, Bram?
I had to try and not have this be a long story. I'll try and condense it. And I mean, I don't have the conversation I had with the owner, Dan Ingles. I don't have it in front of me. I actually meant to look through it again ahead of this, but you saying that reminded me that I had to do that. The first instance with them was actually Alan Smith from Discovery. He was helping out. I think it was one of those things, you know, the guy wanted to run Scotland. Alan had been doing Discovery. The guy was wanting to do Edinburgh, so kind of, I guess he just wanted to. It would make sense to someone who's local to the area, who's done a wrestling show before, or maybe Alan volunteer help. I don't know. You kind of thing have to ask Alan. But I first heard about it because of Alan, and I like Alan. You know, I've known Alan for a while now. So they were doing an interpromotional Butter Royal on an Edinburgh show, September 2015, I think it was. As a bunch of companies were involved. And I'm thinking, well, why can't WrestleZone be a part of that? So me and William Sterling ended up putting our names in that. And it's like, oh, I mean, yeah, might be fun. So, I mean, you had, I think, yeah, the Target was in there, Reckless was in there, you had PPW. Can't remember all the promotions, there was a heap of them. But me and William were representing WrestleZone. So we did that, Battle Royal, ended up being one of the final two. It was fine. The building was big and not particularly full, which already is like a bit of a red flag. Like, for me, if you're starting something out and you start big from the start and you've got no grounding, there's no foundation underneath you, I think you're setting yourself up for a fall. I don't think there's anything wrong with running a little town hall. You know, little town hall, 100 people in, nice little crew, sell merch, make some money. Because that's essentially what WrestleZone was. Like, WrestleZone like didn't do the beach ballroom as a first thing. Because that's what it'd be like. It would be like WrestleZone going, right, we're doing a beach ballroom, here's Jim Duggan, here's Billy Gunn. It's like, that's madness, because who are we? What have we done? It took us years to get to the point where I kind of thought, okay, we could probably do this. And as it was, we sold it, turned people away. It obviously was the right thing to do, because it worked. And the rest is history. So already I'm thinking, already I've got a vibe. It's like, okay. And so we do that show, good little show, but the building's empty. And you've got Nick Aldis on the show, you've got Ricochet, you've got John Morrison. I know I'm forgetting, but ODB was on there. You had, it's going to be an expensive outlay for the talent. So already this show's lost money. Again, it's not my fight, it's not my problem. I got paid, fine, did it. But already I'm thinking, you know, because the guy was using... shows as a way to push his video game. And I've never played a video game, but by all accounts, the game is an absolute train wreck. Yeah. And it's, you know, like knockoffs of Jeff Hardy and Goldberg and Randy Orton and Brock Lesnar. And it's just cringy. It's bad. It's just Bush League. But he was using these shows as a way to push his game, which I thought was a very weird business model, because he was banking on this game making millions. And it was never going to. There's people playing the game. I had an early primitive version of the game backstage in the Edinburgh show. And I didn't play it, but actually forgot Chris Archer was on a show and I ended up getting him a refereeing gig. Don't ask. He did a fantastic job, by the way. It was just bizarre seeing Archer refereed Viper against ODB, and it was hilarious. But it was good. But he's actually a cracking referee. Who knew? I wanted to help him out. So he was playing the game, and he's too nice to have an opinion now because he loves everyone. So he's not saying, but the game is like, this does not look good. So already I'm thinking, this is not going to work. I think the end of that show, they announced that they were getting an AJ Styles. Like, well, that's not going to be cheap. But you know, obviously they had Mysterio, and Mysterio costs a fortune, and rightly so, because he's a legend. But I think, how is this going to work? So didn't really have too much to do with it for a wee bit. Terms of guys to speak to, Krieger and Luke and Sharp can tell you some cracking five-star stories, so if you want to get them on.
I've heard the Luke and Sharp dressed as Rey Mysterio story on a podcast before, which was incredible.
I've heard bits and pieces from them, just like wild. He was doing Dundee, so he had the Dundee show. So he did Dundee and then he came back. My timeline's a bit fuzzy with it. But 2017, out of the blue, he starts messaging me saying he's doing Aberdeen. He's not asking about, I'm not saying that, that you can't run Aberdeen. What I'm saying is, for me, as a courtesy, you would give people a heads up that this is something that you're doing, as opposed to laying it on someone and saying, oh, by the way, we're doing this. Now, I'm not stopping anyone. You can do what you bloody want. But if it was me, I'd give someone a heads up.
At least to not clash with dates. I mean, that was the big stink that caught was in Dundee at the time. They clashed with a date that the company there.
Well, it's like, and that was dealt with badly because it became a big peeing contest in public and everyone looked really, really stupid. And I think it's toys at the pram and you look like children, and I think it's embarrassing. Again, it's another story for another day. But so I was speaking to him privately and just saying, look, you know, you're doing Aberdeen, but do you take into consideration that this date's closed? Also, the WWE were running a show that year as well. So I'm thinking, we've got us, we've got a five star, and we've got the big boys coming in. I'm thinking, Dan, none of us are going to do particularly well here. So I'm not thinking you can't do this, because who am I to tell anyone you can't do something? But already I've got a negative opinion of this guy, because I just don't think he's doing things right. I think he's telling me, oh, by the way, we're doing this. Then he's asking me about, oh, could you check the local paper if there's anything for our show? Yeah, but the show that you're doing that you never had the courtesy to tell me about in advance. So already I'm thinking, you're a bit up yourself, but okay. So I'm thinking, right, okay, they're going to do Aberdeen. It's going to be the AECC. And I would love to work that building. And I know some of the boys would also love the opportunity as well. So I thought, okay, well, how do we get someone out of it? It's like, look, and I said, look, if you're going to be in Aberdeen, you may as well have some of our guys on there because we're local. It's not going to cost you trans. We're here. That's the least you can do. And to be fair, he kind of mentioned it off his own back. So that was a bit of time. That was just for the Beach Ballroom. So this show is going to be in July and our Ballroom show is in June. So already I'm like, and you're coming in with Rey Mysterio. How can we compete with that? You know, so that's what I'm thinking. I'm just being honest with the guy. And like I said already, I think he's a bit, oh, here we go. He's not quite listening. Okay, he's determined, I'm doing this because I want to do that. Here's the same guy that had stuff in the paper about giving CM Punk $1 million to come in. Shut up. Just shut up. Just shut up. So already I'm just, okay. So I started saying to him, look, me and Sean Johnson would be a nice little thing to maybe have in your show. So I'm thinking, again, Sean would like the opportunity to do something in the AECC. So he's like, okay, we'll do that. And then I'm kind of waiting for the right time to be, well, how about this guy? How about that guy? I'm trying to get as many people in here as I can to give them the opportunity to work their building. Because the chances are we were never going to ever be able to run that building. Now, the laugh is neither could they, because the show ended up being cancelled twice. But at least I know enough to know, well, we play can't do that building because it costs too much to hire and we need to bring in Hulk Hogan to fill it and he costs too much money anyway. So what's the point? So already, whatever. So he sees that I'm annoyed about not giving us a heads up about the Aberdeen show. So now he starts trying to, like, you know, like, for the boys, sometimes the best way to appease someone is to give them something that they think that they want. Well, I didn't want anything, really. My issue was, well, I would let someone know in advance, but he didn't. So now he's offering me to be involved in the match that Ray's involved in. So he's offered me the opportunity to work with Rey Mysterio. Not in a singles. It was some convoluted multi-person thing. And it's like, well, okay. But then I said to him, well, what happens? Does that mean if I do this, does that mean Sean's out of the match? And he says, probably. I said, well, I'm not doing it because I promised to Sean that I'd try and get him involved. So technically, I turned down work in Rey Mysterio so Sean could get the booking he was at one point promised. Now, I knew fine well that this show was never going to happen because I read him thinking, red flag, red flag, red flag. I was also technically booked for the Dundee show the week before. That got cancelled. Aberdeen got cancelled. They rescheduled dates. They got cancelled again. And then the business went under. But yeah, so he's trying to appease me because most people would say, oh my God, yes, it's fine. But I said to the guys that I would try and get them something. So I said no to work in Rey Mysterio because it meant that some of those guys might not get something from the show. Because that's more important to me than someone trying to kiss my arse. Because I'm not interested. I don't need my arse kissed. I don't think I'm heavy in the grand scheme of things. I don't care. I've got principles. And that's probably why I haven't done more than what I have. Or maybe I'm just not good enough. I don't bloody know. I don't care, but I know that I thought I did the right thing. But I also knew in the back of my mind, this show's probably not going to happen, and it didn't. So I haven't told many people that. I told Sean, and I know he appreciated it. I told some of the boys, and that's about it. So first time I've ever said it. So technically, I said no to working with Mysterio because it meant Sean would be out of the booking.
I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, your priority as well is WrestleZone and the Northeast. Yeah. So
I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem with someone coming in and doing Aberdeen. I mean, it's not ideal, but you know, let's make it beneficial to both parties. I've got a problem with someone thinking you have so little respect for everyone else around you that letting them know in advance was not even on your thought process. So already, I don't like you. Because yeah. I would do that for someone. I've done that for people. We've had people messaging about doing shows in different areas. Oh, could you come and do a show here? And I could have said, yeah, we'll do that. But then I told the person, no, well, your local promotion is this promotion. So here's their email. And then they've got in touch and spoke to them. Because I'm not doing a show in Glasgow. Because someone could email us not knowing there's wrestling in Glasgow, just found us, because when you put in wrestling, Scotland, WrestleZone ranks quite high because it's, you know, like WrestleZone's one word, it kind of ranks in Google. So they'll just message us, say, well, no, because you've got this promotion, that promotion, that promotion, get in touch with them because it'd be unreasonable for us to step on their toes. Mm-hmm. Now, I know most people don't think that way, but when people don't, I've got a bloody problem with it. Mm-hmm. And the whole thing was a cluster, you know, the whole thing was a cluster. Yeah.
I mean, like I'm saying, like your priority is WrestleZone because the more guys you can get on that show, the more eyes come back to yourselves. Did World of Sport ever get in touch with you? Because they were supposed to run the Beach Ballroom.
Rob is it's another story. Wow, I never thought about that. so when I ended up in Judge Rinder, which is another thing we haven't even spoken about, which was fun, you know, I was on the telly. I mean, whatever, it was what it was. So the reason I ended up in Judge Rinder is because there was a guy working for ITV called Rob. I can't remember his last name, unfortunately. Lovely, honestly, lovely guy. Such a nice guy. I didn't know what the show was, Judge Rinder. I thought the person messaging me on my wrestling page was taking the mickey. I thought it was a prank. I actually thought it was one of the boys with like a burner account, just taking the piss. And so I don't know, it's like what's Judge Rinder? So I spoke to actually it was Steve. Steve was sent in a question last time. I messaged him because he wasn't working at the time and he was watching daytime TV. So I said, Steve, is Judge Rinder a thing? Oh yeah, it's really popular. All right, okay. But the guy Rob was originally from Aberdeen and he knew WrestleZone and he knew me. So he wanted to get us involved because he just thought it'd be a good deal. So he wasn't necessarily like making or directing or producing the World of Sports show, but he had his hand in it in terms of recommending people. And he put my name in a list, but it never came anywhere, which I didn't think it would, because there's so much talent out there that it's hard to jump over those guys. I mean, the people that ended up on the World of Sports show, can't grudge any of them. So yeah, they should be there. So it's fine. But Rob put my name on the list, but it was more, I was on his radar, but I wasn't on their radar. It was just because Rob liked me. So Rob tried to get me on World of Sport and it didn't happen, which is like, oh, I still got to do something cool with ITV and it's fine. But yeah, he tried to put a word in for me. I don't think it went any further than that. And, you know, and that's what happens. I mean, like, some things come off and some things are just never spoken about again. And they can't take stuff personal because I never thought I had a chance. But it was nice to have someone within the system actually thinking about me. But so, yeah, I very, very briefly flirted with the idea of being a part of it, but it never went anywhere. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when they were coming to the ballroom again, did they contact you guys to help out, or was that just, it didn't happen anyway, but...
Nothing at all I can remember. Kind of on topic, but similar kind of, I remember when Global Force was a thing, Nick Aldis was going to run the ballroom for Global Force, and that never happened either.
That would have been something. We would have had the bars of gold in the corner as you walk in, and Jarrett there trying to sell it.
Worth your weight in gold, Global. Shout out to Eddie Sideburns. He's a big Jeff Jarrett stan account on Twitter just now.
Yeah, Eddie and Connie as well. Connie's someone hoping to get onto the Untitled Wrestling podcast, the spin-off, to speak about TNA, because I could...
Monty Brown in particular, I think. Monty Brown's her favourite, right?
Yeah, I could speak about TNA, especially that time, the Wrestling Channel era, pre-2010, and maybe a little bit into the Hogan part of it. Mm-hmm. That was my kind of time for TNA, but that would have been incredible seeing a Global Force in the Beach Ballroom.
Yeah, it was never good. It was one of those things that just I can't remember the extent of how the conversation ended up, but it was one of those things like it's not going to work. I totally forgotten about that as well, man. So much, like, you know, I don't know, but yeah, with Five Star and the World of Sport and Global Force, it's like they hired, like, because they were hearing, oh, there's wrestling in Aberdeen. Okay. Yeah. So us doing well for a wee bit there, we weren't so under the radar anymore. And people became aware, there's wrestling in Aberdeen. Oh, I never knew that. And then people were sniffing about it. It never came anywhere. Because like traveling all the way to Aberdeen for some people just isn't practical. You know, it isn't practical to come to Aberdeen necessarily. It never came to anything.
Many have tried, but many have failed to make a dent into Aberdeen. I mean, WWE once a year, I think that's pretty much there. There are
I mean, the WWE come, and I mean, you can't fight against the machine. You know, it'd be stupid. It's stupid. I mean, I've been watching WWE since I was 10 years old, for goodness sake. That's what you do, you know, but the days of them coming to Aberdeen and drawing 4,000 are gone. They're gone now. You know, because they would do 4,000 easy. And now is a fraction of that.
I didn't get to the last one just because time. And, well, I was trying to, because it worked once. I tried my journalistic stretch to try and get tickets. And
did you?
It worked once. But annoyingly enough, I waited that long. I bought tickets for the show, and then they went, oh, yeah, we'll give you 2 free tickets. I've already bought tickets now, so I just sold them. So I tried the next year and then got nothing. So the one time I've tried to use, oh no, I tried it at World of Sport as well, and I got a goodie bag to give away. I never received the goodie bag, and then when they cancelled the Aberdeen shows, they cancelled the competition as well. So.
Ah, that's right. I remember. Yes, right. Yeah, you did have a competition. Yeah.
Yeah.
So. I did wonder how that would go down, because I had my suspicions that things weren't going to. Because I'm pretty good for now for having a gut reaction on things. And it's like, you know, good, bad, or indifferent. I'm a pretty good judge now of, I don't think this is going to happen. Yeah.
I'm getting a little bit better with that. I'm when I see companies pop up now in Scotland, I'll follow them on Twitter, but more of a, I'm not so gung-ho and going, right, how can I promote you? I'm more like,
yeah,
let's just see how your social media presence is first. Then I might approach you.
Well,
or if you approach me, I want to wait out a little bit. Lay of the land, yeah, kind of thing. Because there's some...
Agreed.
Some pop up every day and they promise shows that never happen. So I'm just like, nah, I'll wait for closer to the time and let you actually figure it out first. Because
yeah, there's one right now in particular. It's just Red Flag Central. The flags are doing this, and I'm just going, okay,
yeah,
okay, cool. You know, I was saying, oh, we're going to do this, and even, and I know it's not the same thing, but even with AEW saying they're going to present it as a sport. No, you won't, because it's entertainment. I don't have a problem with them doing what they're doing, you know, because it was never going to be what you said it was going to be. It's fine. I get it. I'm over it. I don't care. But some people are annoyed by it. Or they're doing skits and doing that. Yeah, that's wrestling. They should have never said that it was going to be a sports-based presentation, because it wasn't going to be. The moment Cody said that, I went, no, it won't. It won't be. And it isn't. And it's fine, because that's what it is. That's what wrestling is now. It's like, that thing's niche. It's niche. It's not broad enough. Wrestling needs to be broad. Now, if AEW want to be a player, they have to be broad. So they should be broad.
Honestly, yeah? I mean, wrestling nowadays, to get people interested, it's not the wrestling bit that interests people. It's the moments. It's the viral videos. It's. I wasn't a big fan of that. At this point, it would be months old, but the Dinner Debonair show tune, it just, nay for me. That's that slides too silly on my silly scale. And I like a guy who comes out with a bit of bread and calls himself the Bulgarian Baker. I think that's hilarious. But and even I entertained by the Sistos, even though my head writer, Adam, does not. But yeah, that stuff, that's silly. But I found that too silly, the show and dance.
Yeah, there's a line. And no, there's got to be a line there, but it's never.
But it works. I mean, like, I'm not going to judge anyone. If people go on Twitter going, "Oh, it's the best thing ever," to you it is. Cool, go for it.
Yeah,
I don't mind what you like. Right. Okay. So I'm going to throw some of the questions in that I got last time that I didn't actually ask. I need to find Kriger's one. He asked, "Why is Brutus Beefcake the most over wrestler to never win the top title?" And Brutus Beefcake Fanny searched himself and liked that tweet as well.
He did, yes, he did. Why is he the most over? Well, I mean, the really cynical, jaded answer would be because he's Hogan's pal. But in reality, this is funny that mentioned this, because me and a couple of friends were discussing this recently about, at one point at 89, you think your top faces, you got Hogan and you got Warrior. Well, who's number three? It was Beefcake. And you think about it, right? Give me another person. You got Hogan, Warrior, who's three?
Tugboat.
He isn't. Not there, is he? But 89, Tugboat came in 1990, really, I think it was. So you think about the time where, so you've got Zeus and Savage against Beefcake and Hogan at SummerSlam 89. Now, you watch the match and watch the point where Beefcake gets Savage in the sleeper and everyone has like an epileptic fit in the ground. He was so over. He's number three babyface in that company, only behind Hogan, Warrior, Beefcake. Like, who else is there? Give me another babyface. Give me a babyface who's number three in 89 that isn't Beefcake. You can't, in my opinion.
I'm trying to think, because my era, so I'm only going back retrospectively.
Well, you think about your baby faces. I mean, taking away tag teams, baby faces, Tito. Well, Tito is over, but he's not number three.
He's Tito.
And I mean, who else you got? Bossman wasn't baby face yet, but Bossman would be a number three, but he wasn't a face at that point. He was still a heel. Beefcake's number three baby face in that company. in 89. And he is. It doesn't matter. So he's not a good worker. It doesn't matter that it's like, again, what's a good worker? It's like the people liked him, so he's working fine.
Probably. Yeah. Hang on, to go back to being Hogan's mate, are you telling me that he main evented Starrcade just because he was Hogan's mate?
Yes.
Yeah.
I have nothing else for you.
No.
Beefcake in 94. Beefcake in 94 was not over. Beefcake in 89 was the top three most over guy in the country. He was. Because I can hear he was.
The last time I saw Beefcake was Hulk Hogan's Celebrity Championship Wrestling.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I loved it. But I liked ITV's Celebrity Wrestling, and it was awful.
I watched a few of them, and I must admit, they were fun.
It's just a shame that the winner was Hogan's mate, because Todd Bridges was by far the better wrestler. Not Dennis Rodman, but, you know, that's...
You're still not over that, are you?
I'm not. I get fixated on many things, much like the tag team tables match from Aberdeen Anarchy. You hurt me that day.
I wasn't in the match.
Just the general wrestle zone.
More stuff to worry about that night. Was that Anarchy 2017? Yeah, it was. It was a year before that I forgot a boot. I forgot one of my boots. Anarchy 2016 was when I went into my bag and my boot was gone. And a very kind Mickey Vago drove me home to get my boot.
You told me that last time and I had Mickey Vago on last week. I should have remembered that because that was in our season finale.
In the finale, yes.
Yeah. I didn't ask him about that. I should have done.
It's a Vago. I've left my boot here. Come on. It's like, thank you. Hey, so I'm driving up the road and the show's on. I think the show was on as we were driving up the road to get my boot. It's like, idiot.
Sam, you must have Lord Michael Graham returned, was it, One Night Only? Was it 2017? I can't remember. The years are just merging into one night. Where he got eliminated before the bell rang in the Battle Royal. And then...
Yeah, technically he's never been eliminated. So technically that Battle Royal is still ongoing. For like 3 years. Oh no, sorry, 2 years. It was 2018.
Oh,
it was 2018 in the pre-show. It was.
Hang on, is it the actual show that I'm wearing just now? I don't know.
No, that's 2017 you've got on.
Right, okay.
I don't know.
It's all merging into one nowadays. I've been going to WrestleZone for haven't went this year, but it's 7 years, so yeah, it's all just merging into one.
I feel like I should know these things, but a lot of something is just like...
That's fine, you got the website to keep you updated.
Yeah.
And us, we seem to be keeping things records for some
reason. God bless you.
Right, other questions I got two from Caleb, and... Mm-hmm. You told me that there was one you thought he'd ask, so I'm going to get to that because I need to know. But the first one is, name four WrestleZone names to play the original Ghostbusters.
Oh, my God. Well, Alan Sterling's Peter Venkman. That's easy. Caden Garrick is Winston. He's every man. He's a grafter. He's a hard worker. Egon is Richard R. Russell.
Okay.
Is he though? No.
I don't know why I had it in my head, but I thought William Sterling would be Egon. I don't know why. It just doesn't
Egon's either Richard R. Russell or he's Reese Dawkins. He's one of our commentators. Because Reese is a bit of a brain box. Actually, Reese is Egon. That's it. That's perfect. So Reese Dawkins is Egon. And Ray Stantz is James Chesser, one of our referees.
Oh, yeah.
That's amazing. Actually, I would watch the hell out of that one. That's amazing. I get it booked. That's another reboot. I'm going to make that reboot. That's my cast. Perfect. That's a great question. So happy with that.
Is so that's going to be the next video series after the Manton files.
Mr. Yeah, they seem to be done just now. Like Lee's had to just Lee's got other stuff going on. It's a shame. I like them. It was more of a lot of it. I know a tangent again, but you know, it was nice to do something that was kind of like not canon a little bit and just a bit kind of, you know. Yeah, again, it's something I think wrestling needs to kick up the butt and, you know, like the heel to fall on his face and a bit of ha, you know. I think there's a place for that, so I enjoyed that.
And plus, you see things like we speak about AEW, like being the elite stuff, and it just keeps things, some stories ticking over and that without actually having to physically,
yeah,
do bumps and actually hurt yourself and stuff like that.
Yeah, no bumping's good.
Yes. And the other question, well, before I get to the big one, is create a WrestleZone band, any genre, assign instruments to each band member.
Oh my God, I can't do this off the cuff. That's an amazing question. Oh my God. Well, I need to be in it for selfish reasons because, you know, there's two things I wanted to be, a wrestler or a rock star, and I couldn't do rock star stuff because I'm not good enough. We're metal, we're heavy, like we're super heavy.
Scotty and the Swifts.
Wow, that sounds like I don't know, that sounds a bit more hair metal, pop punky for me. No, I don't know about a name, that's a tough one. I'm pulling rank, I'm selfish, I'm vocals. But it's gonna be guttural, like I'm not a proper singer, I'm just going for it. Caleb wasn't a band, but he was vocals. He played an instrument. Mikey Innes is rhythm guitar, because he's really good. Blue Thunder used to play bass, so he's a bass. Drummer, I think Crusher Crave would be great. Straight at him drumming away would be amazing. I don't know, I don't think he can drum, but screw it. It's my fantasy, so it's fine. So that's the four of us, and it's heavy. It's heavy, like it's proper heavy. It's good though. It's tight. It's tight, but it's heavy. Yeah. Phenomenal question. That's a phenomenal question.
If I had a Photoshop guy, I would try and get that. Maybe we can give him a
shout. Adam's really good at that stuff. I can't get my head around that at all. All that editing, even me doing the Zoom, it's like, wow, it worked. Yeah, it actually works. I can hear him. It's good.
Yeah, I did all the logos for the site, and I've done all the logos for my site, but that's probably as far as I'm going. I'll do the odd like putting a face on something, and then that's it. I'm not getting really too technical with it because I don't get it.
It's kind of beyond me. I mean, God bless people there, and also it's so time consuming as well. I don't have the patience now. I used to have patience for stuff, but now I'm just like, don't know.
Is it worth the time?
Especially when there's someone out there that can do it in a quarter time and it'll look better than I can ever do it. So here, I'll pay you to do it. You do it. It'll look amazing. You do it.
And the other, well, not question, because it was something that you brought up to me, was Caleb's, one of his favourite stories was Scotty Swift almost killed a guy. I want to know more.
Oh my God. Right. Okay, this is one of Caleb's favorite stories ever, and the great thing about the story is every time I tell it, it won't change because it's true and it happened. That's the beauty of telling the truth. The story won't change. So a friend of mine from back in the day, this must be 2004, maybe it was 16 years ago. So I'm just a youngin, and a mate of mine called Richard. He started doing a DJ in like a club night in town. I think it was like a Wednesday night, so it wasn't going to be busy. So I said, I'll come along because it's going to be quiet and have someone there. So he played a couple of songs that I asked for. I had a good drink and a good night. Perfect. Leave the club maybe at one-ish. So we're walking through town, head back to his flat, play for a couple more drinks, whatever. I think I might have been at college at that time, so it must have been like a late start the next day. Oh, screw it, I'll have a drink. So we're walking through Union Street, which is the main city, the main street in Aberdeen, if you don't know. So we're walking through Union Street to head to King Street, which is one of the main roads. So we're walking along and we get to where there's a junction with the traffic lights on that street. and I can see some guy banging on a landing door, screaming and yelling. So we're like, okay, what's this? So he's about maybe 20 feet away from us. So we're going, okay, what's going to happen here? So we look up, and out of the one of the living room windows, there's two girls screaming at the guy to, like, leave us alone, bugger off, whatever. So they're clearly distressed at this guy. I'm assuming this stranger who's banging to get in a landing door. These two girls are panicking, and it's 1:30 in the morning. So we get close enough to him, and then he clocks us. And I was like, come on, mate. No, they're clearly not happy with it. Let's just, that's enough. Leave him alone. So the guy, who's just, his eyes are rattling. So he's on something, whatever. So he comes up to me. He headbutts me. Boom. But he doesn't really, there's not much behind it. I'm just like, oh, did I get headbutted? He's grabbed Richard by the scruff of the jacket, and he's thrown him onto the road. So luckily, it's 1:30 in the morning. It's a main road, but it's quiet, which is lucky because a car could have easily hit him. So at that point, I'm thinking, nah, I'm not having that. I clothesline him from behind and knock him to the floor. I put him in a crossface, and then I'm wrenching on it, and then I hear this, and he just stops moving.
Jesus.
So I think, have I just killed a man? So let him go. He's there. He's on the deck, on the pavement. He's not moving. He's out. Look at Richard. Richard looks at me. We look up to the girls who are out the window, who are now, who've just seen this whole thing unfold. I look up to them and say, "Don't tell anyone," and we run. I don't know. My first thought was like, "Oh my God, what have I done?" I just panicked. And 1:30 in the morning, it's a whole thing. His flat wasn't far away from where we are, like a five minute walk, but it was a 2 minute run. So we run back, and the whole time I'm thinking, God, have I killed someone? It's like, what happens if, like, no, what if I've broken his neck? What if, like, he just stopped moving? I heard a crack, he stopped moving. So but 6 o'clock in the morning comes at Luke. I need to head back the way we came to see if this guy's still there. So I'm thinking, I'm going to get around the corner and find this corpse laying there. And he's gone. There's a wee puddle of, like mucus and blood. It's like, oh, okay, well, he's up, he's mobile, he's away. Right, so make my way through Union Street again to go to a taxi rank to get a taxi home. And then as I'm walking to the rank, I see the guy. He's outside a hole in the wall taking money out. He sees me, so I think we're probably going to fight here. But a part of me is just like, I'm so glad you're alive. I'm so glad you're alive. I don't care if you beat the crap out of me. I'm just happy you're alive. He sees me. Has no recognition on his face, doesn't recognize me at all, goes back to it, takes the money out, walks away. I go home, go to bed.
Well, that was more intense than I thought it was going to be. Because I was going to cut the camera back going, I had one fight in school, I used 3 headlock takeovers, and the guy gave up. That was my only ever fight.
That's good though, 3 headlock takeovers in a fight is good. Well, I was actually quite impressive to get 3 of them in.
Well, I thought, I don't want the guy to hit me. So if I get close enough to him, he can't hit me, so I'll just take grab him down. Take him down.
No, we have him by the head. You then control the body. So.
Exactly. Now let him back up, thinking, right, that'll be it. Oh, he's came back to me. I'll just do it again.
He took him down. Then he fed for another one. Then he fed for another one.
Yeah. Then he got up and just went, and then left. So, yeah. Cool.
That's usually how most fights end. They just kind of just end, don't they? It's like, oh, that's it.
I think it was to the point going, he's just going to take me over again if I come next to him. Yeah, so I'll just leave him now. Okay. So, yeah. Scottish Road almost killed the guy.
Yeah. So clothesline and a crossface. The reason why you do moves a certain way, because you're doing them for real. So, yeah. That's a... Oops. In my defense, it was out of trying to protect 2 women. In self-defense, because he headbutted me and threw Richard on the road, and that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. I didn't think I'd end up almost killing the guy.
Did you ever get flashbacks when you're thinking, thinking, "I'll put a crossface on, maybe not. Actually, I won't put a crossface on."
No, not really. It almost feels like another lifetime ago, and it's like, God, that really happened, but it did. I can remember it so vividly. I can remember being back at his flat, thinking, "I've killed a man. I've killed a man. I've killed a man." I'm not proud of it, but it's a hell of a story.
Let's change gears a little bit then. Just a little bit.
When... You're not going to get this on any other podcast.
Definitely not.
No.
So we've tweeted back and forth quite a lot in general over the last few years when you've mastered Twitter. One thing that you revealed is when I got blocked by Jerry Lynn for reasons I didn't know, and then I got unblocked by Jerry Lynn, and you said you had a story about Jerry Lynn.
Yeah, so... it's not a major one, but it has it actually came to pass. It's not a lot to tell, unfortunately. I was hoping there'd be more. It's actually funny as well that the reason I didn't meet Jerry Lynn, it was a 1PW show, October 2005. I think it was Doncaster. Because we went to the one, it was one in Coventry, the one in Doncaster. So Doncaster one, I think. It was a big meet and greet before the show. And the reason I didn't have time to get a picture with Jerry Lynn is because I was talking to Tracy Smothers. And Tracy Smothers was trying to hawk his pictures to me. But it's pictures of him with like Steve Austin and Jerry Lawler. And I wasn't interested. And I kind of wish I had now. Because I like Tracy Smothers. I thought he was a riot. So it's just interesting. I was speaking about this now when obviously Tracy just passed away this past week. But Tracy's the reason that, because I'd forgotten until one of the boys reminded me. Yeah, it was Smothers was the guy because he kept talking to you. And it's like, yeah, that's why. So I just had a random memory of it. You know, I'd put a thing up saying, I'm still gutted. Like, no, because one person out of the ECW, kind of those guys that I wanted to meet was Jerry Lynn. Like, I'd done Raven, done Sandman, Dreamer, you know, but I hadn't met Jerry Lynn. So I just remembered it one day. It's, oh, I'm still gutted about that. And then I get a DM from Jerry Lynn 10 minutes later asking for my address because he wants to send me a signed 8x10. But it's never shown up, which might mean maybe he's just forgotten. Maybe it's gotten lost. Maybe he didn't get around to sending it like till recently and it's still on the way. But I got a DM from Jerry Lynn 10 minutes later asking if for my address to send me a 10, a sign 8x10, which I thought, what a bloody nice, what a thoroughly nice guy. And then you're telling me that he blocked you. It's like, no, Jerry Lynn's lovely. What are you talking about?
That's the thing. That's the bit that annoys me the most, because I was like, I got initially, like when I was younger, I was a bit more brazen on the Twitter and I got blocked by Chavo Guerrero, but it was very much warranted at the time. So like, I thought, okay, I know why I got blocked by Chavo. That's fine. Won't repeat here because I was very young and very stupid. I was 15. And yeah, to see Jerry Lynn blocking me for just random, I was like, oh, why? What have I done?
It's just bizarre that Lynn would block you for no reason because, you know, I don't know. Who knows?
It doesn't matter now. He's unblocked me. So the Twitter campaign worked. I bugged him. But yeah, speaking of bugging, you don't want to be the guy that messages him back going, that 8x10, are you sending it?
Yeah, I'm not gonna mess him back because he's not, you know, he didn't have to do that, you know. It's fine, it's okay. It's just kind of cool that he even care enough to message.
Jerry,
where's 8x10 that you did not ask money for and you did not ask to pay for me to pay the shipping for? How dare you not send me? Like, what kind of a arrogant piece of you know what I would be? Is like, no, that's. But no, people do that though. Oh, where's my thing? It's like, shut up. Yeah, I might see it, I might not. But hey,
I'm terrible. Well, I'm not terrible for doing that. But yeah, there's a lot of times I've got folk going, oh, I'll send you this. And what's your address? Oh, it's this. And then I've never seen it. But I haven't paid for it. So it's not, there's no loss at my end.
Exactly. So, yeah. It doesn't matter.
And another screeching halt in festivities. I wanted to speak about Sheila. Because Sheila, for those unaware, was a super fan of WrestleZone. I would see her at any event I would go to. She'd be there. Of course, she was a big front row. She passed Sanjay a walking stick, is one of my fond memories with her. I know it's going to be a bit of a tougher subject, but what was it like seeing Sheila in the crowd, seeing just her enjoying the shows and of course not seeing her anymore?
We put two and two together that we knew of Sheila before WrestleZone. The shows in the music hall, you know, you got your tribute shows where you have fake Undertaker and fake Kane, fake X-Pac and fake Road Dogg and blah 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 blah, fake Legion of Doom. one of their music hall shows. I think it was 99, maybe 2000, about that time. And it was Barbarian against Avalanche, who was PNUs, if you remember PNUs from back in the day.
Yeah.
So they were having a hardcore match. And Barbarian's done the gimmick, you know, usual thing. He's taken the chair and he's wedged it in the corner in the second or third to send him. So he's working over Avalanche, blah, blah, blah. Gets the chair, wedges it in the corner, goes to get Avalanche to send him. And then the time it takes for Barbarian to go and get Avalanche, this old woman stood up and pulled the chair out. Just taking a chair out of the corner, and she's standing there with this look in her face like, you're not doing that. I'm not letting you have it back. Not while I'm here. And then it wasn't until someone said, that's Sheila. I said, oh my God, it was. Sheila was the one who pulled the chair from Barbarian. And Barbarian, like one of the industries kind of, you know, like you speak about guys who are like tough guys, like Meng and Barbarian and Steve Williams, like Barbarian is one of those guys. But what do you do against an old woman? I mean, I mean, you can't hit her. And then if you try and get the chair from her, then you don't manage, then you look like you're totally inefficient. So I think Barbarian just went, oh, well, don't matter. Okay, then what do you do? So that was our first experience of Sheila, and that was before WrestleMania was even a thing. That she is super mad on wrestling, super fan. I've got a couple of Sheila stories. One time she jumped and ruptured Russell's ankle. I think it was the end of Damien against BT Gunn, or it might have been Damien against Lionheart. It was either of the two. I think it might have been Lionheart. Lionheart. Maybe the pump kick or super kick to Russell when he's on the apron, and he goes boom down the floor, and as he's there, he feels someone jumping on his ankle, and it's Sheila. It's like, okay, so what do you do? I mean, it's like, Sheila, don't please. And then she was told, please don't do that. And it's funny, but don't do that. No one should be doing that. But it's Sheila, so it's almost like, oh, Sheila, does it make it right? But still, I remember. Without getting into the details, because it doesn't seem right. But anyway, it was Baldom Show 2015, and Sheila ended up, she was outside the building, and she was very upset about something. Exactly what, I'm not sure, but, you know. So the staff had taken her in from outside and taken her into the office, and they figured, oh, maybe... it was 2014, sorry. And they figured, oh, maybe if they got X-Pac and Scotty through, you know, that would cheer up. You know, like, you know, I mean, the guys, you know, I mean, you know, the stars of the show, the guests for that show would maybe park her up a little bit because she kept speaking about Scotty. So they thought, well, we'll get X-Pac and Scotty to Otty through. So they come through to make a big fuss over her, and she's not happy because it isn't me. She was asking for me, not Scotty to Otty. So I'm somewhere else in the building. And I know that X-Pac and Scotty have went, I didn't know exactly why they were going where they were going, but so I told, well, it's Sheila, oh, right, okay, well, Sheila wants to, okay, it's Sheila, it's going to make her happy, it's fine. And Scotty came in, and she was not impressed. And it's like, I don't want to see him. And I'm thinking, well, like the guys from WWE. So she wouldn't settle down until I came through to sit with her for 10 minutes. And that was obviously... The show's happening that day, and I mean, there's still this lot of stuff going on before the show, you know, as you can imagine. So whatever I was doing, I had to drop it because Sheila was like upset because it wasn't me. I was like, right, and I'm thinking, these guys are like, you know what I mean? Like, what? And she just loved me for some reason. One time we did a charity show, you know, for the disc lot. The people know, like, no, the Brian McKenzie and guys on the chair. It's like his group. Like, I've known Brian forever because I used to be best friends with his son. It's weird how things work out. Everything comes full circle. And so we did a charity show for them because it's something that they want to do. Is that, like, we've been speaking about this for ages. Let's do a charity show. Sorted, we'll do it. So the last match of the night was myself and Sean Johnson against Alan and William Sterling. So just a night off. This fine, fun match, whatever. Then I got Sheila in the ring at the end. And then she comes in to chase off Sterling Hall, and Bill and Alan, they know what they're doing. They run away from Sheila to make it a big whole production. So Sheila's in the ring with me. She's chased off the heels. Everyone's happy. That was a lot of fun. I know that meant a lot to her. They gave her Alan and William gave her that moment, which is cool. You know, they know. And then for a while there, it's like I used to have the staff at the Beach Ballroom would ask me every year, "Oh, where's Sheila? Oh, have you seen Sheila?" Because in a wee bit there, she disappeared, and I feared that she'd passed away. And she hadn't, and then she reappeared again for, I think she reappeared for Summer Hill Show. So I'm thinking, oh, that's good. And then not long after that, she was away. It was Brian McKenzie messaged me saying that Sheila had passed, which wasn't a surprise.
It's one of those things that she was if you go to a wrestling show, there's the wrestling regulars. You see them every show. We discussed last time. But even like my wife was, she'd only been to a few shows, but even then she was going, "Oh, where's Sheila?" Because like she'd only been to a handful of shows, but she knew who Sheila was. So there was just
everyone knew who Sheila was. They were still here, like people taking pictures, like just. If there was like a band playing at the music hall, Sheila would be out of her seat, standing in front of the stage, dancing away. And people would send pictures to me and say, "Oh, I saw Sheila last night, and here's she's at this gig at the music hall." And she's like everyone in the building is sitting down, but she's like, you know, like she's alive and still at the party until the day she went.
Definitely the epitome of, as the kids will say, YOLO.
Just living
her best life kind of thing.
Excuse me.
Amazing. Right, so I'll keep not on that subject because that would be morbid. You mentioned Lionheart. Of course, Lionheart was part of appeared at some Aberdeen Anarchy shows and I'm assuming other shows before the ballroom era began.
Yeah, the early days. He was around for the super early days. But that was Johnny era, you know, WrestleZone. Me and Lionheart were never really friends. I understand why. I didn't understand in 2020, I understand why. Because here's a bunch of new guys who don't know the head from the arse. And he's probably thinking, "Oh, what is it now?" You know what I mean? Because now we're speaking about new companies coming up, and me and you are going, "Well, here we go." I get it. I totally get it. It's non-personal. Me and Adrian were never... I mean, one of the first guys of note I wrestled was him. And I learned the one thing from it, like, we weren't close. We never were going to be close. We're two different people. It's fine. It doesn't matter. It's fine. I learned a lot working with him. Like, I learned a heap. Even just because you say what you want. I mean, we weren't super close or friendly, but he would sit with guys with their matches. And I know William Sterling... when William was big, because he dropped a lot of weight, but when he was big, he could move. Like Bill wasn't a big fat guy; he couldn't do anything. He could move, but he would do stuff just because he could. Yeah, you know, and he's sitting with him. Why not sitting with him, watching his match back? He'd say, "You know, it's great that you can do that, but I mean, you're twice that guy's size. Why are you avoiding contact? Why are you not going through him?" And he's like, "It's just my opinion." And he's like, "No, you're right. It totally makes sense." So just stuff like that. I mean, because we were learning as we went, and he made a big difference. Now, it's a shame, but because Adrian wasn't involved with us for a long time, and then we got him in, had him for a charity show. He's in for Anarchy against Bingo and Crusher. And there would have been more, obviously. Obviously, we know what happened. When he was coming back and stuff, and you know, I was actually I'd never spoken to Adrian before. I've spoken to Lionheart. I'd never spoken to Adrian. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's always Lionheart. And then when he came back in for that charity show, he was Anarchy. Speaking to him back and forth via Facebook, that was the first time I'd spoken to Adrian. And we're getting along well. And it's like, oh, it took about 10 years. You know, because I think 10 years on, he's like, yeah, these boys, they're fine. I get it. I totally understand, because you need to earn your stripes. Yeah. And he probably thought, you know, because a lot, again, I said before with part one of this podcast, a lot of the early days was bad. It wasn't good. So what is he going to think? Oh, it's not very good. Correct. I didn't see that then, but like 12 years on, totally get that.
Yeah, now you're kind of seeing things from
his hard feelings.
Point of view.
No hard feelings. It wasn't hard feelings anyway. No hard feelings at all. It's like, mate, I understand. Because now I feel the same way. I see someone, I was like, what the hell was that? But that was me 12 years ago. Hmm. You know?
He's definitely, from any interviews that I've seen, pre and post, of course, what happened, it's always a case of Lionheart and Adrian. himself, he was cautious, but once he let you in, he would let you in, kind of thing. So
yeah, there was two set. Like I said, I knew Lionheart for a long time. For the last 6 months of his life, I actually got to speak to Adrian. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, and again, there's people that were affected by his death. Yeah. I was affected by his death from the point of view that here's a guy that from a wrestling point of view, helped a lot. I know he helped me a lot. Whether or not he recognized he was doing it or not, he did. Because working with him leveled me up a little bit. Yeah, Him and a Welsh guy called Matt Vaughan, he didn't wrestle anymore. He was briefly in OVW for a wee bit during the Cornette era. And I got a chance to work with him a wee bit. Him and Adrian were the two people, and it was like, oh, okay, all right, got it, cool, thank you. Yeah, so that was Adrian made a big difference, not from a personal point of view, but the wrestling point of view.
So let's kind of cheer up conversation a
bit. Okay,
because I could ground it to a halt there with that. I want to speak, I don't know why I wrote this down, but I'm going to speak about it. You've competed in some different matches over the years, and the one I wrote down here was blindfold match versus Super Executioner. What was it like working a blindfold match? What's it like working against a Super Executioner? Just in general. For those that are listening, Sky has bowed his head, probably in.
I don't know. No, there's not going to be a lot of wrestling involved. I think as well, Super Executioner is a heel, but he's a comedic heel. I think for a babyface to work against a comedic heel, the babyface has to have a level of personality and charisma to not get overwhelmed and overshadowed. Again, Alan Sterling's one. You know, he's a comedic heel. And there's arguments against that heel shouldn't be comedic, but my argument against that is the babyface has to level up as a personality. Looking sharp, not so much now, but early looking sharp. He's a comedic heel, and you need to be on it as a babyface, because he's so entertaining that you can't let yourself be overshadowed. Like, you have to find a way to react to his shenanigans that are as entertaining to the audience as his shenanigans. And for me, working against a heel like that, you should always try and get the crowd with you, but you really have to get the crowd with you there. When the heel does something that's silly, but is entertaining, that's when you have to go to the crowd and be like, do you see what, like, is it just me that saw that? So now they're with you. Because if you don't do that, the people aren't going to cheer for you anymore, because it's going to be entertained by him. And that's the thing I learned the hard way. And actually, after working with Looking Sharp, that's like when Len Ironside was like really feeding back stuff to the guys after matches, and I said to him, "Nolan, what do you think about like the show and the match and everything?" And he said, "Well, the one thing you did there was you didn't let yourself be out entertained by the heel who's entertaining." And I was like, "Right, okay," and that stuck with me as a thing. Like, I didn't know I was necessarily doing it, but he highlighted it. So with the Super Executioner, it's the same thing, because he's a heel, but you don't really hate him. You're just like, so when people are rolling their eyes, I think the babyface has to be rolling their eyes with the people.
I was about to say, our reaction, yeah, which is, you have to be with us.
I'm basically your filter. It's like you're all reacting one way, and I'm going, "Look, I know, I'm on it. I've got it, guys, I'm on it." Because if you don't do that, then, and you're just two-dimensional babyface, then you're good. It's going to get over like a fart in a church. It's not going to work. It's going to a lead balloon and every other cliche I can think of. So, and again, I think that's the one thing I think I am good at, is reacting to the situation and bringing the people in the ring with me. Because if you don't do that, then, you know, it's hard. It's hard. It's easy to be outclassed by a heel who's entertaining. Yeah, and a Super Executioner falls under that category. So, like, you can't be an introverted babyface. You can't be into yourself. You need to be willing to do stuff that makes you look a bit silly. And I don't care. I mean, I'm in my pants. Who cares?
I think we were saying last time, we were saying, like, when you see the trainees come out first, they're all hunched over. They're not letting the crowd come in.
But yeah, once they actually
pull their shoulders up and let people in, you can be as silly as you want, as long as you have the crowd with you at the time.
The thing is, well, and again, like, that goes to, you speak of guys being like that, I mean, I'm like a legitimate 6 foot, maybe six, I'm not 6'1", but I'm six and a tiny bit, or whatever. If I got my boots on, I'm 6'1". If my hair's up, I'm 6'3". I walk around like I'm 6'4". So always walk around like you're taller than you are. Never be smaller than you are, unless it's for a reason. Unless you're the sneaky, you know, if you're, and again, if you're sitting in a crowd, which you often are, and you're looking up, the ring's a stage. The whole point is you are meant to look up to us. Yeah. So if you're looking up to someone who's also projecting themselves as taller than they actually are, I mean, you know, when you're a kid, you see someone, "Oh my God, he was 8 foot tall." Well, he wasn't, but in your head, he was 8 foot tall. You know, Undertaker was 7 foot tall. No, he isn't. He's close to it. He's built, whatever. You know, like, Hogan was never 6'8". So, I believed it. Because Hogan presented himself as 6'8". So, it kind of all ties in. Another tangent. But, again, if you're working against someone like Super Executioner and you're like this, you're dead. You need to be kind of, everything needs to be a little bit more bigger. It needs to be exaggerated. It needs to be animated. He's a riot, and I know we don't see a lot of him. I'd like to see more. I'm with you on the Super Executioner fan club. It's me and you in the fan club, because I think he's a riot.
Well, just to,
I'm a fan. I like, again, laughing. I like laughing, and again, people will argue that a heel shouldn't make people laugh. I think there's ways to make it work if that babyface reacts to it in a particular and certain way. I understand the argument, but I also think there's a place for it on a show, because you can't all be serious, rah, 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 rah. I'm going to kick your butt. It's like, that's been done. Yeah, you know, we need some fun, especially now. Absolutely.
Definitely. Yeah. Just to tangent myself, my favourite, I've seen a good few Super Executioner matches now. My favourite one was Fraser Bra against William Starling.
Was that with the lightsaber?
That was with the lightsabers, but that wasn't even my favourite bit. Well, that and the music came on, which was amazing. But the my favourite bit was when he snuck into the crowd and went to the merch stand and pulled the tables across and then put his head in to pretend he was one of the masks.
It's amazing. He's done that a couple of times and never just, gets old.
I was front row, and I was like, I just pretty much turned my chair just to watch this happen. I couldn't believe. I thought, it's both simple and genius at the same time. I mean, it didn't work, But
like matches, you know, like matches like that are almost like a think tank. It's like, well, how about that? Well, we could do that. We could do that. We could do that. You could do that, and it just gets silly. And then you'll have, well, we can't do all these things because we'll be here all night. But maybe we do the four things that we think, you know. Because I mean, often if something makes you laugh, there's a good chance that the people will as well. Now, they won't hit a home run every time. But, you know, if we're laughing at it, then I'm pretty sure some people out there are going to think it's funny as well. Because if it pops the boys, let's say, you know, if it pops the boys, then it must be good. Yeah, so, yeah, I remember that match. And, like, you know, like a lot of the shows in Fraserburgh, something is, I mean, the smaller shows, it's easy to forget every match in them. But I do remember that one vividly because I was nuts watching that.
That whole show, actually, it was you against Aspen, if I remember right, because I really enjoyed that. I wanted to see more.
Yeah,
of that.
I enjoyed that. That was fun. That was a fun one.
The match, just I think it was a rumble at the end, some sort of battle royal, and the match before it was Crusher knocking out Alan Sterling, and Alan was there for the whole.
That's right.
Interim, and he was there at the start of the match, still in the middle of the floor. So
I'd forgot about that. That's right.
That Fraserburgh show is just it was a riot from start to finish. I really enjoyed that. As part of your WrestleZone career, you're actually only one championship away from actually having the Grand Slam. For those that are keeping track, because I am, obviously. So you've been No Limits champion, Undisputed champion, Tag champion with Jay Lethal and John Lyons. We discussed that last time. And, of course, you've won the Regal Rumble. So when the shows come back, is that where you're setting your sights when it comes? Or are you just Tri-Counties Championship? Or are you just first one to get onto the shows and see where you go from there?
I mean, before we went into lockdown, I kept getting knocked out by Dino Del Monte and his roaring forearm. So, yeah, there might be unfinished business there with those guys. I don't know. I mean, I'll just be glad to be doing shows again. I mean, right now, I think looking for certain things to happen or chasing certain things, I'll just be happy to get the ring up and just do something. Yeah, honestly, I'll be happy wrestling the Sisto. Fine. I'll happy wrestling Super Executioner. You know, I'll be happy that people are allowed to come out and not just a wrestling show. You know, I don't miss going to the pub. I don't care. Well, that's a lie. I miss having the option of meeting up with the boys and having a drink. Yeah, I don't necessarily miss the pub. I miss seeing the guys. I miss going to a gig in a big way. I really do. I want to jump in a car and go on a toy hunt because I haven't had a toy hunt in a year now and it's driving me nuts. You know, even though I don't have any room, but I don't care. That's the stuff I'm missing right now. Mikey Innes, like, he does a lot of acting. He does a lot of theatre. I'm not a theatre guy, or so I tell myself, but every time he does something, I go and see him. Can't go to theatre right now. Yeah, I always go and see him whenever he's doing something. I can't do any of that stuff right now. So I'll just be happy that we can do something. Really, I'm easy. I mean, if I never win another championship again, I'm totally at peace with that. Because, you know, I didn't think I'd ever be a wrestler. And I said last time, it's like, well, other people do that. You know, the guys in Italy do that. I wouldn't do that. Oh, I'm doing it. Oh, Christ, okay. What? I'm still not at peace and over that idea. I still don't see myself as anything. Because it's like, it's still the kid in me that goes, well, yeah, but the guys in Italy do that, so you're not doing that. Just in the same way, like, I'm not in a band. I said, well, people who are good do that stuff, so you won't be doing that. I said, yeah, I know. So I've never quite, yeah, again, call it a lack of ambition. I don't think it's a lack of ambition. It's just, I just don't see myself like that. I don't. You know, and the fact that there's people that do, it's like the fact that you care enough to sit with me for another, so far almost an hour and a half, is just mental. You know, like, okay. I mean, I'm happy to. I'm delighted to, because I like talking to you. But it's like, okay, that's cool, I guess. You know, it's the way my brain's wired, I don't know.
Sorry, you know? My initial tweet, I deleted it before I sent it to you, but my initial reply was going, well, if this goes well, we could do the live show. We'll do the tour around Aberdeen. We'll take it live, get a crowd, get them to ask the questions.
Oh, I don't know about that, no. I don't. I quite like doing it in here, because this is like my safe place, you know, this is my happy place here. With all my stuff behind me. So
I'm going to speak about that, which probably will end up just taking the last hour and a half of our time.
I'm starting digging stuff out. I've got one thing up there that's beautiful. I've got the Neutrona one that lights up and
And as we established in our last episode, though, you've only got 8 matches left before you have to do something with your hair. So, so you've got a lot to fit in 8 matches if you're in that time. Yeah, that bit that you're saying about the option, that's the thing. I don't really go out. My going out is maybe going to the wrestling. That's about it. But it's because it's having the option, like being told
knowing that you can't
go out.
So like, of course it is.
Now I want to go out.
Of course.
But I never did before.
I'm not the most sociable person just now, but that's more I'm content with what I've got. I mean, the people that I've got around me. I mean, you know, I've got my girlfriend. She's got a son from a previous relationship, and he's great. You know, I've got the dog and 2 cats. My mom and dad are still here, which is brilliant, obviously. I've had the same circle of friends. I've had the same circle of friends in some cases since 1997. And, you know, I'm fine. I don't, you know, and we happy sitting talking with you, great. I like being at home. I do. I'm easily pleased. You know, it's not just wrestling and everything, but you know, there's heaps of stuff I'm into. I'm interested in. I'm super geeky about stuff. You know, I'm never sitting bored. It's always, you know, there's always something. The lockdown thing, it is rubbish, but I think I'm really fortunate that it hasn't really affected me that badly. I don't think. Generally, I'm fine. And I feel guilty because I know there's people that haven't been. But, you know, people ask me, oh, no, you've been okay, is it? Yeah.
I'm fine. I get that because my wife's the social one out of the two of us. If she'll go out with our pals or I'll be coerced into going to things and pretend to look excited. So for her it's like going, oh, I want to go out. Thankfully, her mum's like a single household, so she can still do stuff with her, like as part of our bubble and all that kind of stuff, which is great. So that means I don't have to do anything. But again, it's that not having that option. It's like, oh, I have the option. Yeah. I can go out with yous or I can stay at home. Well, that's my option. I'll stay at home.
Yeah, exactly.
I totally get that.
Yeah.
And the dog, I'm exact same boat as you with the dog. My things, I think since our last chat, I've been dragged into doing once a week like mammoth walks with my dad because they're still about. And last week was 12 miles. It was 12 miles the week before. And we couldn't do it this weekend because the weather was bad, so I ended up taking her out for 6 miles this morning, so she'd be tired enough to not interrupt our chat. Unfortunately, during the middle of our chat there, I don't know if it'll come up on the audio, some idiot is letting off fireworks nearby. So
I didn't hear anything.
She wandered in, had a wee whinge, and then left again. So she's had a wee moan about it as well, so that's fine. Speaking of wrestling again, because that's probably why most people listen.
Yeah, why not? Hey,
I know, exactly. A lot of places at the moment, just because there's no shows on, are putting out like live shows, like their video library on places. Mm. Is that something that you think may happen if this lockdown continues to wrestling? I know you guys have DVDs and that.
Yeah, I mean, again, I think we were hopeful of just, you know, being able to be in a position, and we're not just now, so it doesn't matter. But, you know, obviously when we weren't sure how things were going to play out, just getting, you know, having two guys, a referee, someone to film it, and just do a match. Try and edit in such a way that it's not just one static shot, put it up online, so at least there's something happening. But obviously, when we're in the academy, there's no contact, so we're not doing that. That I think that was what we wanted to do contact-wise, and it's not happening. I'll be honest with you, in terms of the video library and putting stuff online, not doing me, mate.
Fair enough.
I'll be honest, it's like, I just don't, people ask me, have you got that? And it's like, I don't know. I'm terrible. I am terrible. But I also I do other stuff, you know, like I do help run the academy. You know, I am in with the guys before a lockdown. I was in a lot. Obviously, we're not in as much just now. That's not my strength. That's not my department. My department is doing it and helping people do it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I've been focusing on. We're not as proactive with that because of the demographic, I think. Like, no, like for me, the demographic that we have, I can often skews a bit younger. Maybe I think I'm a bit out of touch. I think I'm a bit of a dinosaur when it comes to this kind of stuff. I still haven't caught up. You know, even though, like, I've got the network and I've got Netflix and I've got Amazon and blah, blah, blah. And I've got Spotify and streaming stuff. I just think some people are a bit more on it than the likes of me, and you know, you can take that as me feeling in some way. I don't know. It's never been our priority. I do think if this lockdown or the way things are goes on a lot longer, we're going to end up doing it just because, Christ, how long has it been now? You know, I think if we're still talking about it the same way in 6 months, we kind of have to, because it would be like, Christ, no, there won't be a case of, should be, it would be a case of us saying, no, we are, because how long has it been now, you know? So, I'm not saying it's not going to happen. The whole practicalities of streaming and having it been a good, reliable service is, I don't know.
That's why I'm asking you. I was thinking, I'm sure you might know more than I do, but then again.
I don't know. Again, like today, I was watching, they put up on a network, they put up a little video about people's experiences of meeting Taker for the first time. And it wouldn't load the first couple of times. Just like, well, if theirs isn't loading, then how am I gonna? But, you know what I mean? Or it's like sometimes I watch Netflix. It's like, why is it frozen? It's like, well, like if Netflix isn't working for me, how am I gonna get, like, Scott? Do you want to do that? Not really, because I'll probably make an arse of it, and then people will be moaning at me because it isn't working. And also as well, how much people are gonna use it?
Yeah,
I mean, here's the thing. Yeah, it's nice to have it, but at the end, I mean, like for me, streaming is necessary when you deal with thousands, tens of thousands, hundred thousands, and millions. We are not that. And I think that's a big part of it. Now that I've said it out loud, you know, again, oh, you guys should do that, and it's like, yeah, maybe we should, but how much folk are watching it? A lot of expense and time and effort for something that is like it's not going to be seen by that many people, because. Like, unless you're super invested in something, and we don't have television, you know, WWE's got their network. Well, they've been in TV for how much years now? How long have they been in TV for?
Forever. That's about all of it.
And the company's been around since 63. And they've got a network. Damn right they have, because they've got a video library that's extensive. Our video library is quite extensive. A lot of the early stuff I'm not putting up because it isn't very good. As well, it's like I'm not putting up stuff as rubbish, you know. And as well, the guys have got families to work full time. They really want someone spending 8 hours a day, I don't know how long it takes, whatever, to you do this from it. And it's like, well, that's a lot of investment in time for something that might not be necessarily that productive. Is it worth it just to keep up appearances? Not really. Again, if we're going to be honest, and this is you know, like, and this is our podcast, so I'm going to be honest. I don't think it's worth it. Now, Netflix, of course it is, because that's a multi-million, like, the network's got a million plus subscribers. Damn right we're doing that. Now, the WrestleZone, not so much. Now, I love WrestleZone. I love what we've done. I love that it's people that love what we've done, but I'm also realistic about the amount of people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, that's fine. It's a well put argument. To not do it. No, that's fine.
It's terrible as well. You know, sometimes as well, it's like something I can't be arsed. That sounds terrible. Can't be arsed. You know what I mean? Sometimes it's okay to say I can't be arsed for that.
Yeah, I mean, from my end, it's just more of a selfish thing. When I see folk going, "Oh, this match," if I see Adams write up about it and going, "Oh, this is amazing," I'm just like, "Ah."
I know, like, I do totally see that. I just wish there was thousands of people like you. Because if there's thousands of people like you, we'd be talking about the on-demand service we already have, not the one we're about to do. But unfortunately, we're not in that situation. You know, like for every Billy Strachan, there's going to be, you know, like 100 people who are just very passive to the whole thing. Oh no. Because again, it's like getting people to invest time when there's so much stuff out there. Like, I don't have time to watch all the stuff I want to watch. Mm. It's like the horror service Shudder. I've barely looked at it. I've had it since April. What? You know, I've got Netflix and stuff. I've got the network, you know. I've got books that I haven't gotten to yet. It's like, I'm just, like, for me personally, I'm now sitting watching another wrestling thing in lieu of all the other stuff I haven't gotten to yet. But that's just me, you know? There's only so much that, again, because I've been around it so much, there's points where I just go, get that away from me. Get the wrestling away from me. No. Because there's so much other stuff that I'm super into, you know? I mean, I finished watching Raw 93, and now I'm working away through 94. But that's more like, well, that's my time period.
Mm.
You know, I get a kick out of that. But it's hard for me to watch. Apart, I did watch the match that Walter had with, what was the guy? What's the guy's name?
Dragunov.
Yeah, Dragunov. I watched him and Dragunov from this past Thursday at NXT. I watched that last night. Probably the best match of the year. Holy cow.
I mean,
the match I enjoyed the most, but it's probably the best match of the year for me.
Yeah.
I mean, I probably enjoyed the Taker AJ Boner match more.
Mm.
I mean, or Orton against Edge from Backlash.
I loved that match. It was like the greatest match of all time. Right. It's like
a little bit too long. 5-10 minutes too long. Apart from that, it's wonderful. But no, the match Walter had on NXT this past week is like, okay. That's the kind of stuff that'll get me back in. Because those boys, they were working snug. They were working snug. And it's like, God bless you.
I want to get back into NXT UK, but they've just got, after everything went on in the summer, they've still got some people that have got like question marks over them still involved.
Oh, definitely. And oh, no, I totally agree with you.
I think's missing is they've got fantastic wrestlers, great wrestlers, but where's the characters? There's not as many characters, you know? Yeah. Like we were saying last time when I was saying this is how I like a show. I like a bit of comedy. I don't get that with NXT UK before I watched it. I want a little bit of funny for my money. Even though I don't pay for the network, it was my mate that gave me the login for his.
Oh, really? Oh, wow. Okay.
I haven't spoken to him in 2 years, but he hasn't changed his password, so it's mine.
Wow. Until
further notice.
I'm paying for the network. I'm not a leech.
No, so I really my opinion kind of gets nullified a little bit when I'm not paying for it.
a tiny bit.
But it was best man for his wedding, and this is like, oh, this is my login for a network. Great, okay, cool. Went to his wedding. Haven't seen him since. He didn't come to my wedding, so it was, yeah.
Wow.
So that
yeah, was, just keep using it. That, yeah, just take his password. Yeah,
exactly.
Screw that guy.
It's mine now. So yeah. So there's always a fear every time there's a pay per view. Well, thankfully I'm using the Thunderdome, but till that's over, I can watch it through the Thunderdome. But there's always a fear I'm gonna log on one day and it's gone and I won't be able to watch anything else. But until that time happens,
$9.99 a month. Though, that's a lot of money, is it?
I mean, I've got Netflix, although Netflix, I don't think I'm paying for that at the moment either, because I think it's a joint account with Kelly's mum. And then the Prime is on discount because I was a student at the start of the year and they
You've
do
got
student
it all
discounts.
Worked out.
Well, Prime is even better because they don't reconfirm. So I was a student at the start of the year, I did childcare, and it was a 3-month course, but I was still a student. So I got student discount on Amazon and it was free for 6 months and half price after that. They don't know when I finish. So that's so
you scumbag.
Exactly.
You scumbag.
Always I'm after a freebie. That's why I'm contacting venues going, oh, can I get wrestling tickets? I'm a journalist. So I'm not a journalist at all. I have a website, I have a blog. That's pretty much all I've got. But yeah, back to your point about like you've seen these people on TV going, I can't do that. I've seen like guys like Gary Cassidy and all these journalists doing like real wrestling stuff. And I'm just like, going, that's not me. That's I'll do my list of 5 picks to face so and so in the future. Hey, work for what culture? They got millions on lists.
True.
The other thing about like the media stuff, I think I bugged your social media team about putting out. You did Q&As at the start of lockdown, for a few of the guys, and you did one as well. I was like going, can you put them in podcast form? Because I would like to listen to them when I might walk in. I don't want to watch it on Facebook.
Oh, that's something. But, yeah, that's fair. I guess it never crossed their mind. It's a case of, well, let's just get something out because people are just, you know, I mean, some of the guys were going nuts. I guess the thing, like, I was fine. Again, I felt guilty of it. But anyway, no, you're right. That's probably something, yeah. I agree with that. Any stuff going forward will be a case of any chance of making this an audio as well. So you can, yeah.
If you want a place to host it, I've got a place to host podcasts. So
there you go.
Just let me know. I mean, that was the next thing about doing the Untitled Wrestling Podcast, which I made the logo for before I thought of an actual idea how to do it. which is the best way for everything when doing this.
Just do it. I might use it. We'll use it. It's fine. I've got it. It's fine.
Exactly. I made it. I was really happy about it. I made it months ago, and I thought, right, I better check to make sure this last week, make sure that nobody else has called it. And one started a month ago. I was like, but I made the logo first. Right. So if you stole it from me, or will it look like I stole it from you? So I don't know. But yeah, that was our plan. I was going to do, once the show starts again, I was going to do the WrestleZone recap or something better titled.
Yeah.
At some point.
That's a good idea.
But yeah, if you need a podcast place, I have the space to do it. So go for it. We'll speak about your vast Ghostbusters collection then, because we didn't really get onto that last time. I think the only thing we spoke about, like, not wrestling-wise, was The Exorcist 2. So, you quite like the Ghostbusters, as
nah,
I can see.
Nah, no interest. Stupid hat. Oh, no. I'm all grey and white. I like the Ghostbusters thing. I don't know. I mean, I don't know how you are when you're growing up as a kid, but, you know, obviously superhero stuff is a big thing. You know, Superman, Spider-Man, Batman. It's just never, I don't know. I guess Ghostbusters were my superheroes, and I think I liked it because it was just, like, 4 normal guys who had, like, abnormal technology. It's basically science against religion. If you break it down, Ghostbusters is science against religion. And is it, well, you got religion, but have you got science? And I think that's kind of started my whole, because I'm not a religious person at all. I believe in science. I believe in something tangible. And what they did was they dealt with something that was, they dealt with it in a way that was tangible. It's like, we've got this technology that's like ridiculous, but somehow believable in its own way. It looks like it could exist. Stapoff, there's like, the moment Stapoff appears is the greatest moment in the history of film. And it is, just when he bumbles, oh my God. I remember watching it as a kid, being terrified of Slimer, but loving everything else. I would hide behind my dad's seat when Slimer appeared. When he's coming for Peter, I couldn't cope with it. I must have, I don't know how old I was. 9, maybe 8 or 9, I don't know. So I was super young. I used to get up early to watch the Muppet Babies on a Saturday. But they had like clips of movies during the intro, and one of them was Slimer, and I used to hide behind the seat for that as well. I remember that. It was like, what? I loved the show, but I would always panic because I knew I would see Slimer at some point. And now I've got a shelf of Slimers behind me. So I don't know. Yeah, people like, some people like Marvel, some people are super interested. No, like Star Wars, like Ghostbusters is my Star Wars. The difference is Star Wars has got heaps of films, and we don't. Which is why Afterlife keeps getting delayed. It's just, I need to see this film. I would pay a lot of money to see that film now. I would pay hundreds to see that film now, on demand. But I'm going to wait, because it needs to be seen in a theatre. And I don't go to cinema very often, but for this one, it'd make a difference. But I don't know, I just love it. Honestly, I just love it. It's just, I mean, the first film is like, It's just as dry, it's sarcastic, it's subtle. I think the effects are so amazing, apart from a couple of shots that age really badly. The sequel gets a lot of hate. I think the sequel's amazing. I don't care. Don't even care. I love them both so much. The cartoon's the best cartoon of all time. Fact. I don't know. And that's some of this stuff. I've got more stuff at my folks. I've got stuff in boxes over there. That side of the room's a mess, so you're not getting to look at that. I've got movie prop stuff. I've got wrestling stuff. I've got music stuff. I need another 3 cabinets. I really need like a room, like just a room that's just a room for stuff. But right now, that's not a possibility. Until Adam moves out. Once Adam moves out, I'm taking his room. I don't care. It's going to be a Ghostbusters room. I don't care. I just don't care.
He'll have a suitcase at the door, and you'll just be like holding stuff, just going.
It'll be the moment he turns 18. He's like, "That's your 18 out." Everyone's got their. I mean, to me, it's no different. You know, like, people love Harry Potter, people love Star Wars, Star Trek, DC, Marvel, Transformers. This is mine, you know, And there's thousands of pounds worth of stuff here. It's silly. It's stupid. But for a wee while there, we were going to WrestleMania regularly, and then we stopped. So all the stuff you see is a couple of holidays that I never had. Yeah, it's basically a couple of holidays. I didn't go on holiday. I haven't been on holiday for years. That was my holiday. And I've got something to show for it. And I'm happy with that. I'm totally at peace with it. It's like, it's one of the best things I've done. Because I already had a collection, because when people would get me stuff for birthday or Christmas, it'd be easy. Just give them Ghostbusters stuff. So I ended up with a collection of stuff, but I kept telling people that I wasn't a collector. Or I was trying to convince myself I wasn't a collector. And then the major wrestling figure podcast, Hawkins and Ryder, I was alerted to that. Someone said, oh, there's a wrestling figure podcast. I'm like, what do you mean? How is that a thing? He's like, okay. And just hearing them talk about collecting got me itchy. And then James Chester, our referee, he got itchy at the same time. So me and him were a bad influence on each other. So I would encourage him, and he'd encourage me. And then we went on a road trip to, we went to Glasgow via Dundee and Forfar and ever in between, and just went in by shops and bought stuff. And we came back, and his car boot was full of stuff. I dropped a lot of money that day. It was a good day. But I blame James, and James blames me. And now we've got a group chat on Facebook, which is just about stuff we're buying, and have you seen this? Have you seen that? And so it's escalated a bit, and now we've run out of room in this side. So, and my girlfriend's got stuff as well, so I've bought her floating shelves to get her stuff up as well. So it's a whole process. It's taken the better part of this year. But it's a hobby now, and it makes me happy. And if it makes you happy, then do it. Because I'm not hurting anyone. You know, I'm not an alcoholic and I'm not a druggie. I just have an addiction for stuff I like.
So. I'm exactly the same. My thing used to be wrestling, but now I don't have the space in my house to put it up. This is what my collection looks like. The rest of it is at my folks. This is my collection. I've got some pops and that down there, but that's about it nowadays. But there's a picture on my Facebook when I lived in my flat by myself, and I did wonder why I never took girls back to my flat. And then I looked at the picture back several times. I thought, that's why I don't take girls back to my flat at the time, because it was just a whole wall of wrestling stuff.
Yeah, I mean, like, you're right, because most people will generally look at you sideways and judge you. But to me, I mean, again, you accept someone for what they are. I mean, obviously, I'm seeing someone and I'm in a relationship and I've been for a long time now. But if I was single and went and if I went back to someone's house on a night out, whatever, and she had, like, I don't know, like a wall of My Little Pony, I'd be like, that's awesome. Mm. So I don't like My Little Pony, although I do have one because a Ghostbusters one came out, so I bought it because I'm a psycho. I'm an idiot. It's actually quite cool. So I've got one. But again, even if I'm not, like, for me, I'm not into what that person's collecting, but I'm into the collecting culture. I like it. I'm fascinated by people's collections. Like, someone's collecting, like, stamps, and you got, like, I don't care about stamps, but I care about the fact that you care about something. So that wouldn't put me off. I would think it's cool, but that's just me. So you're right, but that says more about other people than it says about you, in my opinion.
Although, when I didn't move anything when I took Kelly back for the first time. She didn't even bat an eye, and I was like,
good.
Good.
Well, that's right. When you know.
Keeping you.
That's when you know. No, because if someone likes you but then change your mind because you collect stuff, then that person isn't worth your time anyway.
No.
So she's a keeper, definitely.
But no, now I've switched my collection. My collection is just, like, getting autographs, but actually physically getting autographs. I'm not so keen for, like if I go online, I could buy autographs all I want, but I like.
You could, but then you're taking the risk that they aren't legit. You know, like, you need to have some kind of proof there as well. Yeah.
Exactly. I've got a WrestleMania 19 chair back here, and it's amazing. Okay. And it didn't cost me that much, but it's got loads of signatures on it. But I don't keep it as in condition because I don't know if they're actually the signatures. I don't know what signatures they are. Whereas I've got my European belt there, which is signed by DDP because I saw him sign it because I took it to him to sign it. And the Hurricane, I saw him sign it, so I know it was him that signed it. So.
There's too much people out there now trying to forge. It's the same thing with like movie and TV props. This became a big problem where people are just claiming it's that, but without any COA or any proof of anything. So, you know, like because I've got some movie stuff, I don't have a big collection and they're not high end stuff, but I do have some stuff from movies that I like. And you need to do your research. It's like, there's certain people I trust and then there's certain people that I don't trust. So I've got I've got stuff from Evil Dead 2 and Terminator 2 and Aliens, and I've got a couple of Ghostbusters movie stuff, and I've got I've got something at the end of the Shawshank Redemption where Red goes to the oak tree. Have you seen Shawshank Redemption?
I have, yeah.
And Andy's left something for Red by the oak tree. Well, that oak tree was hit by a storm and it went down, but parts of the tree was saved. So I've got cufflinks that are made from the oak from the tree from Shawshank. It's like, I'm having that because just something that represents that film in some way. Because I've got I did have a top 10, but now it's a top 12 because I couldn't narrow it down to 10. So I've managed to get 6 out of my 12. So that's another side project. I'm trying to get like stuff from 12 movies that I love, so I'm halfway there. So it's a thing. So I blame James, and James blames me for the whole starting to, because I used to collect, because I've got wrestling stuff up the Yahoo from when I was a kid, something with folks, and right now I'm in the process of trying to go through it all. Some stuff I'll be getting rid of, selling it, whatever. But I used to collect big time, and then I just stopped, and I stopped for years, and now I've started again. So it's weird. It's just I've got an itch again. And now I'm thinking about Thundercats. I guess some Thundercats stuff as well now. But only the original stuff. I don't want any. Well, that's a lie. I do, but I should really just stick to the original. We'll see.
But the collected bit is a bit like as well. But like the my Kelly loves Harry Potter. That's her thing. She doesn't particularly have a collection of it, but she's got like a couple different versions of the books. So somehow I've made that now my mission. If I go into like, I could go online again. Go online, I could order it. That's no fun. Yeah. That's not the fun of it. If I go to see a charity shop, I go in and see if I can find a different edition of one of the books.
That's what I miss is charity shops as well. I know, like, you know, but I haven't had really a chance to go out anywhere. But you know, yeah, like going out into a charity shop and then taking a chance because you never know, you might just find gold in there. Yeah. I totally appreciate that. Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah, there's a guy who comes to wrestling shows called Daniel who keeps putting up. This is what I find in my charity shop hunt. I'm going, oh, I want to go. I want to go. There's like four here and they're all rubbish. So I want to go to a charity shop. But I don't want to make, it's not an essential trip. So
it's the thing, I'm trying to not, I'm just trying, I mean, basically now I'm only doing stuff that I need to do. Mm. Not that I want to do. So I'm just behaving because, you know, there's too much people who aren't. So I don't want to contribute to any stress. And people stress me out anyway just now. It's just, you know, just people in general stress me out, man. I'll be honest. Especially the way things are just now. They stress me out. Yeah.
No, but both the good thing about getting to social media also comes with the bad of people.
People ruin everything. They ruin everything.
Absolutely. Not a day goes by where I can just go, right, I'm going to quick look at that at Twitter. What's happened? Oh, no. There's another one.
Yeah. No, what is it this time? No, like every day there seems like there's something now.
Well, no, it seems to never end. And we will be in January when this goes out, but I'm sure that there'll still be something. There'll be a new thing that's happened. Another thing that I know that you're quite into, I don't know if you've got anything of your collection, Simpsons. Am I right in thinking that? Is that another?
No. I don't actually. I just get a kick out of the Simpsons SHIT post and stuff that goes up where people just make memes of it. Basically, Monday to Friday on my phone. When I'm on it, will consist of me, Mikey Innes, and Lewis Turner tagging each other in Simpsons stuff because we think it's funny. I love the Simpsons, but I don't. It's like, now that you said it, I want to.
I think
that's my personality. Is like, you know, if you put a thought in my head, go, ooh, I might start getting it. No, I don't have room. I love the Simpsons, but
not enough.
I'm more. Because there's so much content for The Simpsons, there's so much stuff that people can do with it, just making that stuff, and that's what I'm getting out of it just now. And the whole monorail thing became a thing because it was just, it didn't mean anything. Like, monorail didn't mean anything. It was just something that we said to confuse people. It didn't mean anything. It was just one of those things that became a thing. Like, you speak to Dennis Law about that, the monorail thing just got out of hand. It's just what happens when you're with a bunch of boys backstage, you speak rubbish. Yeah.
I think speaking of SHIT posting, I think I ended up, I think Lewis added me on Facebook, I think that's how I ended up joining the Cornetto trilogy
posting. Yeah.
Because I think he must have tagged you in it or something like that, and it somehow popped into my feed, and I was like, I'm on board for that. So,
yeah.
Even though Paul should have been the third one, but that's just...
Oh, hold on now. That's a thing. Okay. I like The World's End. No, The World's End is good. It's nowhere near as close to Shaun the Dead Hot Fuzz.
I agree. That's good. But I think Paul is better than The World's End. So I thought Paul could have easily thrown in a mint Cornetto and they could have slid in there quite easily.
But it's only the Cornetto trilogy if it's pegged right. And Frost, like Edgar Wright writing and directing it, and then, and obviously Paul was an American movie, But you're right, Paul is better than The World's End. But it would only fit if Edgar Wright was doing it. And that's, if I'm going to be anal about it, if it was Edgar Wright, it'd be fine. But you're right. And Paul, again, the sign of a good film is if you can watch it again and again. And, and I've watched Paul more times than I've watched The World's End. And I've watched Hot Fuzz to death. Like, Hot Fuzz is one of my top 12. I'm still looking for a prop from Hot Fuzz, but none has came up yet. So if you see anything, let me know, because I want something from Hot Fuzz.
But yeah, Hot Fuzz, that and Shaun of the Dead is like probably two films I've watched most easily. But no, World's End I've watched it once. I thought, that's plenty. I don't need to see that again.
I've watched it about four times now. It's good. But then I watched Hot Fuzz about 20. So Shaun of the Dead a bit the same. So
I mean, I've only seen it the once, but the World's End, but the bit near the end with the old aliens and that, it gave me flashbacks to Kingdom of the Crystal Skull and Indiana Jones. And I thought, nah, I'm not going through that again, because that was a horrible film.
You know what? I never made that connection till right now. You're right. You have soured me on the end now. Because that Indiana Jones film is not good. Not good. And I went to the cinema to see that and was very disappointed. Because I was like, Indiana Jones film, went to the cinema, yeah, come on. And then it's just Harrison Ford just sleepwalks through that film. He cannot be arsed. He cannot be arsed. And it's just a bit silly. And I know Indiana Jones are silly fun romps, but that last one was just too much for Indiana Jones. It's a bit too silly.
I don't know why people
need... A bit too silly.
I don't know why people have the need to go past a trilogy. A trilogy is a nice set of films. You're getting a DVD set. I know, but I think
Die Hard... You know, the IP, Billy. You need to make money off that IP. Come on.
No, Die Hard. It should have ended at 3.
Oh, it gets started with Die Hard.
It could have ended at 2, but 3, it was fine. 3 was serviceable.
4.0 and... Die Hard, Live a Day, or what's that one called?
Please Die Hard, I don't know.
Please Die Hard. please Die Hard. It's like very polite. No, like 4.0 and the fifth one are just, they're rough. Like number one is like an absolute classic, a classic Christmas movie. Don't let anyone tell you it isn't, because it is. And so is Lethal Weapon. It is, but I Die Hard, just 3, that'll do, done, but no, because money, it's a recognisable, bankable franchise, and they're going to ride it until it's dead, because that's what studios do now, so.
Yeah, I mean, I noticed when you're speaking about Ghostbusters, you mentioned the first two and then Afterlife, there seems to be a film missing in your lineup there, anything from the 2016?
Here's the thing you need to understand about a diehard Ghostbuster fan. Like, the second one came out in 89. And then I have had rumors of Ghostbusters 3 out my backside since 96. That every year there was this, and Dan Aykroyd's got a script, and Bill Murray's back on board, and they're going to do this, and then they're going to do that. And it's just every time it'd be rug pulled out from you every single time. And then, they're going to do a reboot. And I'm just like, cool, there's something happening that's Ghostbusters related, because it's been stop-start for so long now. I want to like it. And I went in the cinema to see it, and I got swept up in the whole fact that there's something new. And I did enjoy it. I did enjoy it. And then me and Charmaine went to see it just ourselves. And then Adam went to see it. So we went into cinema again to see it with Adam. And he really liked it. And I still enjoyed it. But I'll admit that I was willing it to be something that it wasn't. Now, it isn't a bad film. It's just so flawed. It's so flawed. It's so fundamentally broken. It's tonally incorrect. It doesn't know what it wants to be. The film's schizophrenic. It's like, what universe are you in? It's his own universe. Is it? Is it, well, why Slimer and Stay Puft kicking about? It's like, what's that about? Like a shoehorning and throwing stuff in to keep the likes of me happy. Now that works. It's like fireworks, right? The first time you watch the film, and someone like me, who's a complete freak for it, and they throw out stuff and references and nods and the cameos, I'm gonna pop. But when the fireworks are done, they don't leave anything. It's just, they're gone. That's nice. And then the second time, okay. And then every time after that, it's like, it just feels so forced and shoehorned that it's just a bit cringy. I've got an essay that I could write about that and everything surrounding it. All this stuff about the feminist stuff and say, oh, this is important because we're finally getting strong female roles. The first Alien in 1979 has Sigourney Weaver. She's a badass. Aliens. Ripley's a badass.
Terminator,
Linda Hamilton, Sarah Connor. Don't tell me there's no strong female roles. You're starting a narrative to justify your own opinion to make yourself feel important. There's been strong women roles forever. You're lying. Shut up.
Speaking of not knowing what film is, that's what's put me off the DC films, because they don't know what they want to be. They want to be anti-Marvel, but they still want to get the Marvel people into watching them. So
yeah, but aren't they super dark now? Like, DC films are just dark and grey, and it's meant to be a superhero film. It's meant to be, you know, where's the superhero stuff?
That's one of my favourite ones so far, Shazam. Because Shazam is a Marvel film.
I haven't seen that yet, but I've heard it's good. I have heard it's good.
I mean, I haven't seen the last 10 minutes of Justice League, whatever Justice League one was. Because my copy cut out. I never bothered to watch it again. Suicide Squad, I haven't bothered, but I'll probably watch the next one because it's got James Gunn. And so that's probably, and it's got John Cena. And I'm a big nerd for that kind of thing. And I'll forgive a film if it's got a wrestler in it. I'll watch it. I might not enjoy it because I watched Gridiron Gang and it was the worst film I've ever seen.
I was like that. I'm not like that anymore. I used to, when a wrestler appeared in the film, it would get a pass. Not anymore. I used to be like that. I'm past that.
I'm pretty safe. I'll give it a chance, but then there was one with Steve Austin as a janitor that. Oh, it was so bad. It was so bad. The worst thing was he shaved off his goatee. He had this like half goatee thing in the bottom. And I thought, no, this isn't right. You're Steve Austin. You have a goatee full stop. You don't have anything else.
Yeah.
But no, it's, just some of the WWE films are just, why haven't they gone on the network? I don't want to watch them, but why haven't they gone on the network yet?
Yeah, no, you think that we'd maybe, I don't know, just like, you know, like an ownership thing, maybe. Yeah.
Oh, well, what's the films?
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know. I guess it's some legal contract mumbo jumbo that prevents it from happening. But you think it would be? But...
I know, because I'm just really wanting to see The Chaperone. That's
I have that on DVD and it's still in the seal. It's never been out, taken out the seal.
I still have it as well, but it's in my parents' loft, and I think that's where it'll stay.
Taken out. I'll never watch it.
Bending the Rules is the one I've still got in cellophane. Bending the Rules, I was Edge.
Okay.
So, I watched it illegally and then I saw it in Poundland. I thought, well, I'm a big collecting nerd for these things. I'll buy it.
Yeah.
Still haven't watched it again.
Wow.
So speaking of you mentioned you've been to WrestleMania a couple of times. Which ones have you been to?
Went to 28, went to 29, went to 32... Went to 33.
Ah, so once and twice in a lifetime.
Yeah, so... the once a lifetime, we're going to do it next year! There's be so much stuff that... from those trips that we don't have time to talk about at all. Because obviously, it's not just Mania, it's Raw, Hall of Fame, it's the WrestleCon... we managed to hit a couple of Ring of Honor shows as well. Missed out on seeing Jushin Liger because we had to leave. Like WrestleCon had a show on and Jushin Liger was working a tag match and we're watching the show and I'm just sitting there going, Liger's going to be on late because it's Liger. Because I really want to see Liger. I've never seen Liger live. No, Liger's in the building. I want to see Liger. And the Hall of Fame was kind of clashing with it. So I'm sitting there like praying, please get like, you know, like every match, like just hurry up. So I want to see Liger for a go. And then the time that we had to leave to get the bus back to get to the Hall of Fame, Liger hadn't been on, so I never got to see Liger, which is a nightmare. I met Liger, that was cool, but never got to see him work. So I'm still not over that, to be honest with you. I'm not a big Japanese guy, but he's Jushin Liger, like the Liger special. So. No, like him and Muta are both special. yeah, me and you're 28. Once in a lifetime. It's weird. Like that match, like Rock Cena, the build for it was great, but the Hell in a Cell on that show, which in my opinion is the greatest match of all time, it was so good that I didn't care about anything else. I felt bad. And then I recently watched Cena Rock again. Hell of a match. Just, I was drained live because I'd just seen Taker and Triple H have the best match I've ever seen in my life, and I'm there. There's a couple of guys that were sitting next to us. They were just locals, you know, and sort of chatting away to him. And one guy was for Triple H, and the other guy was a Super Taker fan. And the spot, the classic spot, super kick into the pedigree, and then the kick out. It's like me and this guy. I don't know the guy. I've met him that day. We are holding each other. We're holding each other as Hunter goes for the pin, because we're both like, oh my god, that the streak has to be over, and like he's panicking because he loves Taker. Like, I love Taker, but he loves Taker. So these two grown men, strangers, are in this embrace over this wrestling match, and we're holding on to each other. Please kick out, and he kicks out, and we're just like, oh my god, don't know who he is. It's the guy standing next to me, but we're just so into it, you know. You speak about like moments and stuff, you know, that there is like two grown men, two strangers were openly embracing each other because the man kicked out the move. You know, it's like it's an international language. It doesn't matter who you are. I mean, in that moment we're all just like in the building. It's that, I mean, being there alive, I'm biased. But I've watched it again plenty of times, and it's still, I think, is the greatest match of all time, in my opinion. So that made you a special. 29, the 29 was funny because it was outside and it was New York and it was quite cold and it started to rain during the pre-show. So like we're joking about, oh, Vince McMahon's going to find a way to stop this rain. If anyone can make it stop raining, it'll be Vince. And then it got to 5 minutes before they went live and it stopped raining and it's like, he did it.
That, he beat, you know, God. Like, of course he's got a favourite.
Mania 29 was good, but I mean, it was one for me. It's one of the weaker manias. It was great being there, but it wasn't. But it wasn't. There wasn't a blowaway mania. Punk against Taker was fantastic. And I think the next night Dolph won the championship from Del Rio, and the place went nuts. The place went. That's one of the biggest pops I've ever heard. 32 to be like 32 with like 100,000 people there is like, wow. Again, you know what they say, we're watching Mania on TV. Well, that's something that, like other people go to that. Because when I went to Mania 28, the first one, in Miami, big building, it's Miami, it's roasting, it's a lovely day. Walk in the building, I'm like, wow, I'm at WrestleMania. This is mental. It's like, this is what I've been watching on the telly all this time, and I'm here. Like, I'm one of the people that's here. So that Mania 28, to me, was fantastic, just because it was like, you know, and 29 was okay. 32, 33 when the Hardys came back. Mm. Oh my god. It's like Brian Tucker was at that one. I swear to God, I've never seen a man float before. When Hardy, because Matt Hardy says he loves Matt Hardy, his favorite. And when New Day came out, and I'm thinking, I think we're going to get the Hardys here. And I just looked to my left because I want to see Tucker, and Tucker's just like, again, it's like he's a way to burst. And I'm like, please be the Hardys, just so I can see him lose his mind. And Hardys came out, and I've never seen a man jump. So I honestly, he was levitating. He was levitating. And it was like, it was so pure and wholesome. His reaction when Hardys came back, he was just delighted. So for that alone, and obviously what we thought was Taker's last match, which it wasn't. But at the time, I'm like, oh my god, is Taker done? Am I, no, like, have I been here live for Taker's last? And it wasn't, But for that moment, I thought it was. So I thought I was a part of history. But if you haven't done WrestleMania, do it. You have to. I mean, I mean, speaking about being fortunate, I'm fortunate. I mean, I've done four of them, you know, and it's mainly saved for it. You know, like, it costs a lot, but save my money. You know, I didn't make any stupid purchases year to year. Just paying myself, saved up, go to Mania, have a good week, eat like a pig. You have to do it. At least do one. Yeah, in your lifetime.
Well, every year I get asked.
Unless things don't go back to normal.
I'll be there. I'll be in Thunderdome. Fine. Every time WrestleMania gets mentioned, Kelly goes, right, where is it this year? Because if it's Orlando or that, again, let me know. Because we'll save up and go. Because we'll go to Disneyland. So she'll get something out of it.
And we did Disneyland and Universal Studios. We went and stuff.
She'll get something out of it. I'll get the wrestling out of it. So that's the big plan eventually, unless kids arrive or what have you. It'll be put on hold indefinitely. But that's the big idea anyway. Eventually go to America and then I'll get to go to wrestling and I'll get to go. I mean, I'll love either way. I got to go to Disneyland and I'll get to see the Harry Potter stuff and it's just it'll be the best night ever.
I'd wander through the hype mill. Like I'm not a Harry Potter guy, but you'll be impressed.
It is
very nice. It's very impressive.
I'm not a big fan of it, but because she is, I get it because I get to see her passion for it, so I understand why she likes it.
Yeah.
But when I went to see it in London, it blew me away. I thought, oh my God, this is blowing me away. I don't know what America's going to be like. I think it just. I'm gonna have to carry her.
Yeah, a lot bigger. Very vast, very big. Everything's bigger. Yeah.
I think we've pretty much covered the usual question we've got for guests, which I've forgotten in so many episodes now, but I've wrote it down so I'll remember it. What's your favorite dinosaur?
My favorite dinosaur. I can show you my favorite dinosaur. Hold on. Do you remember this guy?
I do, yes. For those that are watching that listen to the live feed, can you explain who it is?
This is Baby Sinclair from the American TV show Dinosaurs. This is actually Charmaine, so I bought it for. It's old, so it's not perfect condition, and the voice box is a bit wonky, but it's about 30 years old now, and it's one of those like. You know, when you're making notes during the year about they say something, oh, I like that, and you go, mental note for Christmas?
Yeah.
So I managed to get one for a decent price off eBay, so I've got a Baby Sinclair. Although as much as this for her, I think it's wonderful.
I was going to say, you said it's 30 years old.
My favorite dinosaur. Baby Sinclair is my favorite dinosaur.
It's 30 years old. I mean, I'm 30, and I'm a bit wonky, and my voice box is a bit broken. So it's just part of aging, I suppose, when you turn 30.
Turning 40 next month. 40. I'm too old for this wrestling, damn it.
I know, hopefully by the time this goes out, the shows won't be back, but at least there'll hopefully be some thought, maybe. You'll be able to maybe do something at the Academy shows again, maybe have a limited audience.
I would at least like to be able to have matches at the Academy with a small crew. Just have stuff content in the can to just put up so people got something to see. A big part of that is you say, okay, let's do matches, but because we've been doing non-contact doesn't really prepare you for contact. So it would be let's get a month or two of contact training and then let's do some matches because you need to ease yourself back in again. I've taken a couple of bumps just by myself and they feel okay, but they feel okay, but it's like, oh yeah, this is what it feels like when you haven't done it for about half a year. It's like, yeah, okay. So we need to ease yourself back in again. I would like to have some content to go up. Ideally matches. Ideally like new matches, but I don't know. I just don't know.
Yeah.
I just don't know.
In the meantime, I mean you at the start of it they're popping out like matches from intros and stuff like that. So, I mean, I'm sure there's still stuff in the back pocket.
There's plenty sitting it's just a case of just, you know, getting out there, and just being consistent with it. Sometimes some of the footage that you get is more for like a review purposes as opposed to public consumption. So you could put something up, but the camera angle is not great, or some of the camera work isn't that good. But it doesn't matter when it's just for yourself to look back and review. So a lot of it, it's not that it's unusable, but it's just like, that doesn't look good, you know. You know, maybe we can't put that much at wide because just, you know, the camera work isn't, because the camera was there not for it to be used for everyone to see. It was just for a handful of people to look at in their own time. You know what I mean? So I think when you put it up, it doesn't look good. It looks a bit bush, and I don't want to put something up that looks bush. So
yeah,
that's a big part of it too.
Again, that's understandable. Anything I put forward, you've put a good case for not doing it. So that's fine.
Yeah.
So final thing before I let you go, because I think we've crossed the 2-hour mark now for our second chat, is the just a quick thank you for doing the Swift Advice articles that you did with us for a bit. That I enjoyed them. I mean, people read them, so that was good. So what was it like actually just putting pen to paper and, so to speak, and putting your thoughts out there? Was there a bit of apprehension in case people come back and go, no? Or,
well, it's funny. Well, I'll talk about some people having an issue with it in a second, which I find hilarious. The thing for me, and I've always been quite honest about this, is when I'm putting up stuff like that, again, like a lot of the stuff that I did for you guys is stuff that I've said out loud a million times to people around me. So it's just a case of, you know, just actually having it documented and in the record of my tangents I go off on all the time. And I think I've said before, it's not about being the smartest guy in the room. It's about listening to people that are smarter than you. So a lot of the advice I'm putting up is because, one, I did it wrong and I balls it and I learned from it. Or two, someone far better than I am passed it on to me and it's worked for them. And some of those people are people that did it for a living and fed their families. So, do you remember Curious Cat?
Oh, yes, Twitter. I remember Curious Cat.
And it was a wonderful thing because, like, me, Dennis, Martin and Mikey would just, like, Simpsons references, or they would ask a question, and I said, well, that's clearly Martin just having a laugh, you know, just a bit of fun. And I got some questions and stuff that came in that were quite good. And then there was a few people burying the articles I was doing for you. And I'm saying, so you're saying that the advice that I'm passing on is rubbish because it's coming from me. You do recognize it isn't my thoughts. It's me learning from people that are better than me and did it for a living for years. So am I to believe that you think they're idiots too? I never got anything back.
Yeah. I got a lot of stuff about, well, because I feature you guys a lot, you're my local company, so of course I am. I got a lot of stuff like that, just going, oh, why do you feature so-and-so? And then someone actually sent me an email from a burner saying, oh, you shouldn't just feature them. And then I went back through the stuff I did, and I went, WrestleZone wasn't the first company I featured regularly.
Yeah.
So I know who's writing to me, because I know why you're moaning about it. So, but come back going, it wasn't the company I started with. It was a different company, and then you guys were closer and I enjoyed the shows, so I kept going back, and it was just easier that way.
See, there's people with an axe to grind will often do it, you know, with burners or anonymously. And you can speak about burner accounts because there's been a lot of them recently. I think people dismiss burner, try and dismiss all accounts like that just because they are anonymous. Some people are doing stuff anonymously because what they're saying is true, but they know they'll get flack if they present themselves as, you know, who they actually are. So I think it's unreasonable to say that all of it's to be ignored. But, I mean, I'm not hard to reach. Neither are you. If you've got a set of balls, just say, because I guarantee it, like, whatever your issue is, like, you've said a couple of things, asked me questions there, and I've came back with some illogical. Mm-hmm. I guarantee you I'll have something to come back to you that's logical and rooted in fact. So, and if that's not good enough for you, then I can't talk to you anymore because I'm nothing else for you. If you really have a problem, just say something to me. Because, like, come on. It's like, well done for letting me know you have no balls. Having no balls is not a good look, Billy. Balls. You gotta have balls. Now, if you got something to say to me, just say it. I don't care, because we're all adults.
Mm-hmm.
You know? But they didn't. And again, people were using, like they said, you got, you know, like the burner, an email from a burner, and with the curious cat. And, you know, it's like, who'd have thought that people would ruin something, a nice little fun distraction to do on your lunch break? Who'd have thought? Who'd have thought that people would ruin good things? So I just deleted it at that point and say, well, you've ruined that, see you.
Yeah, that was pretty much the same. Once I started getting ones that were trying to fuel a feud that I did not want to be a part of, I was just like, well, this is no fun anymore, I'm done. So that was the end of it.
Is it on another one as well? Why do you hate women's wrestling? It's like, well, I don't. I just. I don't know what you want me to do with that. You know, me with my Bailey t-shirt and Bailey figures. It's like, yeah, what? And it's like staying up late to get a pay-per-view because Ronda was wrestling, because Ronda was just like, oh my God.
I think you put it out. I can't remember
how good was Ronda Rousey. How good was Ronda Rousey? Oh, she was just
absolutely
the best.
But I think you put it out there. It's like going, well, round here, they're, if you have, for transport costs and that, there's not that many, if any, women's wrestlers round about here. So, getting them down the road anyway.
Yeah, and it's like, well, why don't you have, it's like, I could go into a big thing about how, it's like, do you want me to go to the houses of people and grab women to drag them to wrestling training so we can have female trainees? It's like, do you think I'm excluding people? Yeah, are you stupid? It's like, if people aren't getting in touch and they don't have an interest, then that's why. It's like Glasgow has got a higher population of people, so just by law of averages, you're going to get more. It's like, I can't be held accountable for people not wanting to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what you want me to do, but the narrative will turn into, oh, you hate it. No, I don't. It's like, I just like wrestling.
At the same time,
starting out is very, very dangerous. It's a very dangerous thing to do. It could be because some people will believe and fall for a narrative. It's like, it's not true. It's never been true. Mm-hmm. You're just lying. And I can't take you serious. I can't take you serious because you're a liar. And it's like, I can't talk to you anymore because you're a liar.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to start talking, actually making sense, we'll chat. Until that point, no, because you're lying.
Yeah. And at the same time, I mean, I'm sure if there was plenty of interest to you or to anyone or to yourselves in general, saying, oh, I'd like to see so-and-so as a female wrestler, so-and-so, then you go, well, at least there'll be a crowd for it. There'll be someone who wants to see that person, so it makes sense to have them. And there's no point in going, here's your token women's match. It's like, no,
we had women's matches booked for Halloween and Summer Hill, and it never happened because they couldn't manage. But no one knows that, because it's not their business. It's like, don't start assuming, because you don't know who we're spoken to. So shut up. It's how I feel now. I'm waiting to turn 40 next month. You think I could be arsed with who's shut up? Yeah, you don't know what you're talking about. Like, until you've been in a position where you have to run or organize something, you say, get back to me later, because you've no idea. Yeah,
I wouldn't even know where to begin with that kind of thing. But yeah, exactly. You mean,
anyway, Ryan, sorry, I got annoyed there. Sorry.
No, that's fine.
It's just, you know, I'm just. Everyone knows better, and I was like, do you? You know, I've watched plenty of of TV shows about, you know, like ER or Casualty or, and like, you know, like Doctor, Hospital. I love House. Am I going to go to the hospital and tell them what to do? I'm a hell, I don't know. But I've watched Casualty. Shut up. It doesn't work that. It doesn't work that way. You know? Sorry. Oh, I'm annoyed now. No, see what you've done. You've got me riled up. And I didn't even say anything. Just you being there has riled me.
But that's the thing. It's like, I mean, for all anyone else knows that before this all went to pot, or even before that, you could have had a whole show dedicated to...
we had a women's match for the Rumble, but then lockdown.
Yeah, so I mean...
I'm sorry, I don't have any vaccines on me.
You're not in charge of people's schedules.
What do you want me to do?
You could have contacted everyone, but they've got matches booked elsewhere. Well, what can you do? So that's the thing to do. So, but yeah, I mean, yeah, I'm all for any matches, any gender, intergender, whatever. I don't care. I just want to see some wrestling. But sometimes people are picking fights for no reason.
There's a lot of that just now. Like, people want to be seen as a white knight, or they want to be seen as, I'm making a difference, and my opinion's really, really important.
Yeah.
It's like, but you're just like, again, it's like, if you're looking for something to be annoyed about, you don't need to manufacture something, because this year has been stinking. We don't need any manufactured narratives to have a reason for you to be annoyed and be in your soapbox. We've got enough stuff to be annoyed that's actually legitimate problems. So pack it in.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I've seen plenty of things. I've seen plenty of things that I've got we call it SWN Towers. I've got like a wee private chat group on Messenger where I just kind of whinge about stuff so I don't have to put it out into public. So I think it's mostly just me now. Every so often just go, why are you doing this? Sticking to your convictions when it suits. And just going, I get to let it out without actually putting it out into public consumption.
There's lots of people. I guarantee you there's those chats all over the country right now with people going, like, what now? You know, just... Because, my God.
There'll be one when this comes out going, oh, that's Scotty Swift. Spoke for 2 hours and about nothing.
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. Well, then turn it off then, dumbass.
I'm with that.
Over 2 hours, me rattling on about, and we could have kept going. There's still plenty, but, you know, we need to...
No, that's we're saving that for the live show. That's it.
Oh.
We'll do King Tut's and... We'll do the Rocks Hotel.
Rocks Hotel and King Tut's. Wow.
Have to be careful taking the chairs up so we don't break Rocks Hotel, yes. But it'll be fine. Sandman. We'll do the Sandman. I'm trying to get any place in Aberdeen. Outside Primark. I don't know. We can do it anywhere. Right. Yes. We'll wrap up now. I think I've now used up all my notes. The only thing I've got, I don't know if I said it in the first one, was just thanking you for doing the birthday video for me.
Okay.
I know that Kelly coerced, well, just sent a message going, please, anyone. And
everyone did something. Everyone of note managed to get something in there for you, so that was good.
So, Kelly recorded me watching it, but as soon as I stopped watching, I was like, no, you're not putting that up. Anyway.
So, oh, I really want to see that now.
I just stand there looking just like confused, which is my normal face anyway. So for folk that didn't hear the end of the first part and don't know where to find you, where can people find you on social media?
Facebook and Twitter. Just put my name in. at Scotty Swift on Twitter and Facebook. I'm bad for Facebook. I haven't been that active recently because I've been trying to be better at Twitter. As I said, like before, my Twitter just would just
one at a time. If we get Instagram, Twitter will follow back.
Yeah, Instagram. Site. I mean, like if you put Scotty Swift in to any of them, you're gonna find me. I mean, I know my hair's not red just now, but you'll probably find pictures of a guy with red hair. It's gonna be me in a red beard. But like Twitter's generally, I mean, I'm on Instagram just for dog videos. Like most of the accounts I'm following just now are all like dog accounts, so that's why I've got Instagram. I'm looking at dog videos generally, and Twitter I'm looking at dog videos, and Facebook I'm looking at dog videos. So, yeah.
Excellent.
Okay, I don't have anything else to plug. There's no shows coming up. The Wrestling Training Academy is open, but we're limited the amount of people we can have in. We can't have anything more than six. So it's a coach and five in a bubble. I've got five guys who are sticking to a bubble. Ideal Monday. I never even got near speaking about training. So we're Monday to Friday. We've got a different coach every night and no more than five students. And that's all we can really do just now because, you know, and no, like anything more than that, it's hard to have your distancing. No more than two guys in a ring at one time when there's no contact. Take note, people who are still doing contact training, I don't know why you're doing that. It's just irresponsible. Here's me like a sucker coming up with notes on my phone to keep all the boys busy during this period where we can't touch. But hey, I'm an idiot. Sorry. That's annoying me. People taking the mickey.
I know. Who would, secret shows, who'd have thought? Anyway, right.
Again, I might be the idiot for actually doing what I'm told. Maybe I'm an idiot all this time for my name not coming up in anything. Maybe I'm the idiot, really. Am I the idiot during all this?
Maybe there's a reason why the North, Northeast and that are at lower tiers, but who knows? Want to speculate. By the time this goes out, it could be all over.
That's none of my business.
Exactly. Right.
None of my business.
So thank you very much for joining me. This has been another mammoth edition. I think this has now broken the record for length, which was yourself before. So
he's talking and you can't shut up.
But no, I'm sure...
That's me, I mean, not you, me.
Once the shows begin again, you've already sparked interest of doing the Untitled spin-off about Raw. So I'll have to actually watch some of Raw from 93.
Watching 93 Raw. I love 93. It's flawed. I know business isn't a good, but it's 93. There's so much good stuff in there. Heel doink. Oh, heel doink. Oh, my heart.
I can't remember if I told you last time, but I when the start of lockdown, I was watching 2001 Raws because I wanted to see Invasion. That was what I wanted to watch. What's the Invasion?
It started off so well, and then it just kind of just...
I still loved it. I was never a WCW guy, so I only ever watched Worldwide. So all these guys were new to me anyway. It was still amazing. I didn't miss Sting because I never really seen Sting.
If Sting had Flair, Bischoff, Goldberg, and Steiner for the first wave of the Invasion, it would have been... It could have been something special, but as it was not going to happen. Not happening.
Right, before we start on our tangent on that, we'll wrap up.
We're talking about Invasion 2001.
I know. For some reason, I wrote down in my notes, wrestling in 1998. I don't know why I wrote that down.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. That's the story of my actual debut.
Oh, right. Okay, we'll get that before we wrap up now.
Oh, for goodness sake.
Go on then.
Because it wasn't really, it wasn't my first appearance. I guess it was my first appearance on a show, but it was such a bizarre thing that I actually forget. 1998, November, no, April 1998, it was the week of WrestleMania 14, I think, or it was the week of, they did a show in Manchester and I went to it. Either way, so for me, like as a wrestling fan, it was like WrestleMania. Then I was on a show, and then I saw a show in Manchester. You know, in a week, whatever it was, 2 week period. So I'm like, oh my God, I'm like 17 years old. So I'm like, oh my God, it's amazing. This was the first time I met Len Ironside, and I don't know if it was how he knew, or because me and my mate Ian at the time, like I don't see Ian much anymore, but me and Ian were the first. Kind of, oh my God, you like wrestling as well. Oh, so do I, yeah. So we jump about in the back garden like idiots. It was terrible, as you can imagine. And Ian was a few years older than I was. But so Len Ironside, I think it might have been through Ian, but Len caught wind that we were a big wrestling fan. So Len had always wanted to start some kind of wrestling thing in Aberdeen, but he never had the amount of people to make it worthwhile. But I think he got a kick out of me and Ian just being so enthusiastic. I want to do something. So there's a music hall show, and the promoter is a guy called Shane, Len, you Shane. I'm fairly sure Len would have maybe worked for him a couple of times. And so I think me and Ian weren't trained. We had no business doing anything anyway, but somehow we'd ended up, Len is like, oh, I've spoke to the guy Shane, and he's going to have, and you Ian can have a match in front of him just to see us. But we're not trained. Now I'm 17 and I'm not questioning, you know, because I'm 17, I don't know any better. Now I'm looking back going, why is this happening? It's like, why are we in a ring? So I remember Shane sitting at ringside and Len sitting next to him, but they haven't seen each other in a wee while, so they're just catching up. So Shane isn't looking at me and Ian at all, and me and Ian are killing each other, doing all the stuff that we did in a backyard, but trying to hit the ropes. We don't know how to hit ropes, we don't know how to bump. The ring has no real padding. It's just wood and carpet and then the canvas, which I knew because I helped take it down at the end of the show. So Ian hits him with a suplex and we don't know positioning, so my feet's hanging out the ring and bouncing off the bottom rope. We're killing each other and Shane's just nattering away to Len. And he's not looking at us. So I'm thinking, why are we doing this? Why are we in a ring doing this? And I think Len just wanted to just make us happy because he probably knew we'd get a kick out of being in the ring for the first time. So we had this match that wasn't a match. It was an absolute embarrassment to everyone involved, I'm sure. And then what ended up happening instead was I ended up being a second on the show for Spinner McKenzie. So Spinner McKenzie, who I remember from all the previous shows, and I hope he's still alive, because he was the first wrestler to ever show me anything. So he was nice about it, but he'd obviously seen me and Ian behave like a pair of idiots. So he showed me, like, here's how you lock up. He's telling me, no, be tall because you're tall, and like, don't cheapen your height. And, you know, here's how you tie up with someone. Here's how you take the head. Here's how you take the arm. So basically, tying up the head and the arm and being tall and positioning the footwork, he showed me all that in a space of 10 minutes. So that's the first person who ever showed me anything. So I'm the second for him in a match. So, you know, like round system second, I've got a bucket and a towel and he gets a drink of water. But he's wrestling a doink because you have to have a doink.
Of course.
Because every indie's had a doink. It's like, whatever.
They still do.
Yeah, I know. So Spinner's a heel and doink's a baby face. So I'm involved in the finish, the whole thing where doink is at the ring and he goes under the ring. Spinner has to pretend like, oh, I don't know what he is. What is he? I've obviously seen him, but I need to play dumb that he's not there. Doing a whole spot. Here comes Doink back in, slides in the other side. Spinner still looking at me. Doink comes in, does the finish, play a roll up for me, like the bucket of water, but it's not water, it's confetti, and he gets spooked, you know, 1, 2, 3. So that's my debut on a show. I'm the second for Spinner McKenzie against a Doink. I didn't get paid, but I got like a free tour t-shirt. But the main thing I remember more than anything else is me and Ian were backstage in the music hall, which I wanted to do the music hall because I want to go backstage again, because I remember the backstage area being lovely and I want to see if it still looks the same way. It probably won't. It might look better. This is like 22 years ago, which is mental. So we're speaking to the referee, the older guy. He's speaking away and he immediately thinks me and Ian are marks. And I am, but Ian really is. Yeah. And I don't care. I'll say it to his face. And he knows it. Yeah, I love Ian. So the referee's telling us about, oh, yeah, we're going to get Hulk Hogan in. We're going to get Hulk Hogan, and Hulk Hogan's going to come back here, and we're going to do a music hall with Hulk Hogan. So I know he's speaking rubbish. But I'm just, again, at my leg, I'm 17, but I've read the sheets, I've read the Observer, so I know, oh my God, Hogan's got a contract for however much million a year to Time Warner. I'm smart, brother. Yeah, I'm not, but you know, I'm 17, I think I do. But so I'm just being nice. Oh yeah, no, that'd be amazing, yeah. So we walk away, and I'm just going, oh. So I went, Ian, can you believe that? And he's like, yeah, that's amazing. Imagine in the music hall. And I was like, Ian, he's not coming to the music hall. You think he's going to breach his contract to work in Aberdeen in front of 500 people? Oh yeah, I never thought of that. So this referee obviously thought we were just idiots. And Ian actually was a bit, because he proved it with that. So he's trying to tell these two Mark kids that Hogan's working in the music hall. He isn't. So that was my first experience of a of a wrestling show being involved. And then we took the ring down, and then I got told to F off, and that was it. 22 years ago.
22 years ago.
And I don't know why I forget that, because I always think debut, your first match, but I guess the first thing was on a show was being a second for Spinner McKenzie. But Spinner McKenzie was the first person who ever, because a lot of the guys on that show didn't give us a time of day. I understand it, but they were arsey. The only guy who made the effort was Spinner McKenzie to actually help and pass him in on and not be an arse. So I would love to meet him again to say thank you. But
so before we wrap up then, my second appearance in wrestling, I wasn't allowed to be part of the booking meeting. I wasn't told what I was doing until I was in the ring.
That sounds a bit right.
I carry on.
Just carry on.
And the match I was supposed to announce was already announced on Facebook 2 hours ago, because I knew it, because I report these things. So I knew it was announced already, but I had to pretend that this was a match I thought of to announce, even though I knew it was announced. I knew everyone else knew it was announced. Anyway, right, okay. That's just
It's not a biggie, but it just
kind of epitomizes what was happening.
Yeah.
Anyway, right. Well, I'll start ranting now, but we'll wrap up now and probably share stories that we'll be able to be going go onto a podcast. Thank you for taking part in the second session. I think we've wrapped everything up. The next one will be in the live shows, and
King Tuts.
I'm looking for King Tuts outside Primark, and we'll move some of the buskers about, and we'll set up.
Give them a nudge, make room.
Hopefully next time we speak to each other properly like this, it'll be face to face, 2 meters apart, maybe.
We can do the elbow gimmick when we come up and say, "How are you doing?"
I'm all for that. I don't like handshaking anyway, so I'm all for the elbow thing when shows return anyway.
Handshake, don't you? The dead fish handshake. The dead fish. That's a wrestler handshake.
And
we don't do that anymore.
No, good. Right, I'm gonna hit stop because we'll end up going to someone else. So thank you for taking part. Bye.